Good morning and welcome to the 37th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. First item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 5 in private today. Are members agreed? Thank you, colleagues. We're agreed. The next item on our agenda today is further consideration of the National Care Service Scotland Bill, and we have two evidence sessions. Panel 1 will focus on certain services related to social care, including mental health services and drug and alcohol services, as well as public protection. And panel 2 will focus on older people and Anne's Law. So I want to welcome to the committee, we've got Eleanor Jane, the Director of Scottish Health Action on alcohol problems. And we have Ciara McDermott, the Senior Policy and Public Affairs Officer for Change Mental Health. And we've got Susan Webster, Head of Policy and Campaigns for MND Scotland. Welcome to you all. Thank you for coming this morning. I think I've been starting off...
Joining us online.
I do apologise. We've got Mark Hazelwood, the Chief Executive for Scottish Partnership for Palliative Care. Many apologies, Mark. I didn't forget about you, but I kind of did. Sorry. I just didn't read below the line. So thank you to you all. I've been asking most people in these sessions what their hopes are for the National Care Service, the things that you hope that it will address. And I guess related to that is a review maybe on some of the integration aspects that haven't been working, that you hope that the National Care Service, because that's it's effectively why it's been done. So if I can go around everyone, not every committee member will be able to go around everyone, they'll probably direct their questions, but I usually tend to do this just to get your general thoughts. So if maybe can go to Susan first of all.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Our hopes for the National Care Service are obviously MND, as you may not know, is a rapidly progressing terminal neurological illness. People have average life expectancy of just 18 months from diagnosis, and within that time people become increasingly more and more disabled. So they have a very urgent need for social care, which increases very, very rapidly. So in a nutshell, what we are really looking for from social care for people with MND is a really strong workforce has the capacity to be able to respond to that very, very quick increase of need in that very, very short space of time. So people, for example, can go from needing just one carer twice a day to very, very quickly needing two care workers four times a day to potentially nighttime care and 24-hour care over a very, very short period of time. So we need a really strong workforce trained and able to actually meet those needs, because currently people with MND aren't getting those needs met. Too many people are only getting one carer, their family are having to step up to be that second care worker. They're not getting care to the level or the times that they need. And the burden of that on people with the illness and their families is absolutely incredible. We have family members who are only getting two hours sleep a night, just because the intensity of the care that is needed is so overwhelming for families. So we need that really, really responsive care workforce in place, and that's what we're really hoping. So that at the end of the day, if that care workforce is there, people with MND can be fast-tracked for the care that they need, they can get it in place as quickly as possible, that anticipatory care planning can also take place. Because with MND, we know the way that the illness is going to go, so there's planning right from the beginning, knowing that somebody's going to get much, much worse, and that can all be planned for and the care can be prepared for right at the beginning. That carers can have the support that they need, that carers, family carers can be enabled to take the breaks and the respite that are outlined in the service, because currently that just isn't there. They don't have, they can't take a break if there's no care workers to step in. So they need to be enabled to take the breaks that they will be entitled to from that National Care Service. So these are really the key things that we're really hoping from for the service.
Thank you. And can I go to Eleanor?
Yes, and thank you very much. Well, I think the hopes for people who are living with alcohol and drug addictions and disorders will be very different to the ones that Susan's outlined for people with MND. And we know that people who are living with alcohol problems and drug use problems quite often feel, very regularly feel stigmatised, and this has a knock-on effect on services, which means that the services that are provided within our alcohol and drugs partnerships locally can be quite often overlooked and when compared to the other health and care services that are provided. We know, for instance, that funding was cut over the years until the last couple of years, when we've seen things come back to same funding levels that were in place 6 years previously, albeit some additional money has now been put in place for the National Mission on Drugs. Which then brings me to my other area, which is that people with alcohol problems, are overlooked or can be overlooked because of this huge emphasis on drugs in the last couple of years, because of the rising number of drugs. So what we've seen is the bandwidth and capacity and resources that are utilised within alcohol and drugs partnerships, the services that are provided, quite often skewed towards people with drug problems. So what we'd like to see is all of this being addressed within the new National Care Service. For instance, this could be done by having representation of alcohol and drugs services or whatever replaces the partnerships on the local boards within the in the National Care Service. We could see better consistency in provision of services and a more joined up approach between those services that are currently commissioned by ADPs with the services that are provided by the NHS. On the other hand, that's what we'd hope from the National Care Service. We don't need the National Care Service to do this. This could be happening now, and we don't want to wait for the National Care Service to be up and running to see this sort of change being taken forward to actually genuinely meet the needs of people with alcohol problems and drug problems.
Thank you, and that echoes very much what we've heard in the informal sessions that we've been having with people who've got family members in need of the services that you outline. Kira.
Thank you, Convener. So at Change for Mental Health, we know that about one in four people in Scotland will experience poor mental health in their lifetime. So we actually support about 1,800 people a week, and 80% of those people actually reside in remote and rural Scotland. So we know from our own research and countless of research done by different organisations that there is currently unequal access to services in rural areas for provision, and that is something that we really do hope through a national care service that we can change, so that every single person in Scotland experiencing a mental health condition can access the support and services they require within their own community. All of our research says that people want to be supported pre-crisis within their community. So again, if that's something we can address under a national care service, to allow people to not have to travel, they can stay and get that service where they require it. We also would like, we know that from what we've seen in the pandemic, that the third sector, particularly in mental health and other areas, have played a key part in providing that support and services to people. So we would really like, through the National Care Service, for the third sector to actually be recognised as a key partner in service provision through funding and tendering and having that access, so people know where they can actually go. Very similar to what's already been said by Eleanor, stigma is also a massive thing that people with mental health are continuing to experience. The latest research by CME on the stigma study has shown that about 87% of people with severe enduring mental illness have experienced unfair treatment from a health service, and that's something that, same with through self-directed support, they've seen as well, is they're experiencing that stigma and not receiving that adequate social care. And it's sometimes health professionals who don't necessarily have the training, and they're not always equipped to they don't know the mechanisms to chat to people who have severe and enduring mental illness. So I say those are the three kind of key things that we're really hoping a National Care Service could hopefully address.
That's very helpful. And I'll go to Mark online.
The National Care Service is the National Care Service is a real opportunity to be part of improving people's experiences of living with serious illness, dying and bereavement. And when I talk about palliative care, I'm talking about care, holistic care for people living with a serious or advanced illness, holistic care, aiming to maximise their well-being towards the end of life, and whether they've got years or months or weeks or even days to go, that's always the aim. And I think you heard from Susan some of the important improvements that can come through improving social care. A real illustration of the vital role of social care in improving people's experiences. I think palliative care is provided across our health and social care system at huge scale. So people often think of specialist services and hospices, which are very, very important. But the bulk of palliative care is provided in primary care by GPs, district nurses, social care in the community, in care homes and in our hospitals. So the National Care Service is a big opportunity for palliative and end-of-life care, because people approaching the end of life are probably the biggest single group in receipt of social care. There are 30,000 people living in care homes for older people, and the majority of those are in their last 18 months of life. Each week, 60,000 people receive care at home, and the majority of those are frail elderly people. But I just wanted to touch on integration, because whilst the focus is on adult social care around the bill, that's not how people particularly experience services. So I think we mustn't lose track of the way in which social care and health services are supported and enabled to work together. And I'll put one last stat, which is that one in three hospital beds is being used by somebody in their last year of life. And as end of life approaches, people move increasingly between settings. So you have more admissions, more discharges. Social care has an absolutely vital role in supporting people at home, avoiding admissions where they're unnecessary or unwanted, and also in speeding people's return to their preferred place of care after an admission to hospital as well. So there's real opportunities, and but it's part of the picture. We mustn't lose sight of the need to integrate with the wider system.
Mm. Mark, if I could just, before I hand over to my colleagues, I want to pick up on something that's been put to us, not just in palliative care, but I am going to concentrate on that. That often it's the person who's receiving the palliative care is the only consideration, and not the wider family. And that we've heard that from quite a lot of people in our informal sessions, is that often the systems that are out there don't take into account other family circumstances. You know, where you've actually got maybe quite an elderly person looking after somebody who's receiving palliative care, and they may also have their own health needs, and they're both looked at completely separately rather than the family. Has that been your experience?
So what I would differentiate between, I think support for family and carers is absolutely a part of palliative care. So I don't think it's the case that those needs are disregarded. I think those needs are often not always met. Just as some of the palliative care needs of the person themselves isn't met. I think an example might be the respite care needs of a carer, providing 24/7 care, and yet we see eligibility criteria to give that person a break, becoming more and more rigorous and being inconsistent across Scotland. And so it's absolutely part of palliative care, and it's absolutely part of the agenda we need to progress to improve people's experiences.
Thank you, that's very helpful. I'm going to move on to questions from Paul O'Kane. Paul.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. In our briefing material for this morning, the first section is titled Hopes and Fears, which is quite broad, I suppose. But I'm keen to understand the concerns that people may have around how this legislation has been structured and has come to be, because I think over our evidence sessions, we've heard quite a degree of significant concern about this being a framework piece of legislation that will then be co-designed after the legislation has been passed. Indeed, I just want to quote something from Tanith Muller, who's the chair of the Neurological Alliance in Scotland, who said, "Scotland's being offered a new structure for care, but without blueprints, a schedule or a budget, we can't tell if it will even stand up, much less it will meet the care needs of people in Scotland, and ministers need to go back to the drawing board and show us all the plans that have developed with people before they ask MSPs to legislate." So I would maybe come to Susan, because I know MND is a member of that Neurological Alliance. Would you share some of those concerns, and what do you think could have been done differently?
Well, excuse me, in the consultation we were asked to, you know, a number of questions, and some of those were, do you think that, you know, the bill will meet its objectives? And, you know, we said in our response it was impossible to say because the detail just isn't there. And I guess that is our fear for the legislation, is that, you know, I think a national care service has got so much potential, but without actually seeing the detail, it's impossible to say if it will actually have will improve people's lives, and that's fundamentally what our charity is all about. The fear for us is that there'll be structural change, but actually, in terms of the social care that people are receiving, that just might not change at all, and it absolutely has to. We're supporting families that are absolutely at breaking point, that carers that are completely distraught and in despair. They just cannot cope with the lack of care that they're receiving, the lack of training that social care workers have in terms of being able to support them properly, and just the lack of support for family carers as well. So that is our fear, that we can't tell from this legislation if things are actually going to improve. There is a worry that the structures will change, but actually in reality what people receive on the ground really might not be that different, and it really, really has to be. There's also a concern that so much potentially has been included in the legislation, or has potential to be included in the National Care Service, that it might actually water down the capacity to provide, to really improve social care for people with MND. That is a concern for us as well. And as you see yourself, we just can't tell. We just can't tell. And I would touch on what Eleanor said as well. With an illness like MND, with the short life expectancy, we need improvement now. And I think that is very important. We actually need to start seeing improvement now. 5 years is a long way away, and, you know, hopefully it will deliver, but we do need to see these changes start and have confidence in these changes now.
Thanks, convener. Susan, you preempted my next question, which is essentially, if we look at the Feely review, for example, and what was agreed to, if you like, in that, and drew a consensus within that, given the nature of a condition like MND, would you have preferred to see more action more quickly on some of those issues that were raised in Feely, particularly around workforce, non-residential care charges, support for people and their families?
Yeah, I mean, I think workforce really is fundamental, because, as I highlighted earlier, we want to see fast tracking for people with MND. We want to see anticipatory care planning, but that cannot happen unless you have a really strong, at capacity, trained and valued workforce. And the sooner that we can see that, the better. So all the things that we have hope for in the National Care Service can only be delivered if that workforce is there, and it's a lot more effective than it is at the moment.
I wonder if I might briefly come to Eleanor Jane on broadly some of those similar themes. Obviously, The scope has extended beyond Feely, and we've seen elements of social work being suggested that could go into National Care Service. How would SHAP feel about that in terms of the strong links there are between social work and supporting those who have problematic alcohol and drug use?
Well, the way that ADPs operate now is quite, I'd say, unique and also potentially overshadowed by other sort of structures and areas of the health and care sort of set up in Scotland. And so the ADPs are overseen by health and social care partnerships, or that's their sort of sponsoring body. Funding comes to them from the NHS, well, ultimately from the Scottish Government via the NHS to ADPs. So they get core funding, and then they get bits of extra funding, for instance, to do with the national mission on drugs. So it's all a bit... at this point in time, the setup isn't necessarily working, but that's not to say that we think the National Care Service is necessarily the answer. What we wouldn't like to see, though, is that this sort of situation where ADPs and the services that they commission are still sort of in this strange kind of grey area, I guess is a way of putting it. If the NCS, the National Care Service, is set up, if this sort of continues on the side, it will potentially just continue to be overlooked. On the other hand, we are at risk, I suppose, of having the National Care Service, all the resource and attention being focused onto what we don't even know it's going to look like at this point in time, but that's going to take so much time and resource that actually other areas like ADPs will continue to be overlooked. So it's a really difficult situation at this point in time to see what the right answer is. What we don't want to see, I guess, is that ADPs and the service users fundamentally continue to experience stigma. And we want to see that addressed and think that the opportunity that the National Care Service affords in this regard to potentially remove some of that stigma by seeing them as part of a mainstream kind of setup will help potentially address that stigma. So that's one benefit. But there's so many risks inherent with this because we have absolutely no idea what it's going to look like in reality.
I wonder if I could just briefly, if possible. You mentioned resource, Eleanor Jane. I wonder, are you concerned about the resourcing of the National Care Service, given the Finance Committee's concerns about the total cost and given some of the press we've seen this week around the Scottish Government budget, which we'll hear later in the week?
We'd certainly need clarity about what the costs are going to be, and we would like to know what that's going to translate to in terms of the provision of alcohol and drug services. It's really important that we see transparency. We know Audit Scotland has previously reported that the financing of ADPs is totally untransparent. There's nothing published at a national level which sets out finances and where it's going within ADPs and what results it's actually delivering. At the same time, we know that people with alcohol problems, the number of people with alcohol problems accessing those services has gone down fairly dramatically over recent years. So all of that, if we're now then looking at the National Care Service, and that's where commissioners and the strategic view is focused, we can only expect that to continue when it comes to alcohol and drug services, and that's really going to be letting more and more people down.
Okay, if we can
move on to questions on mental health support from Emma Harper. Emma.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, everybody. So what you're just saying, Eleanor, about stigma is interesting. And Kira, obviously, I'll come to you about mental health and where you see the National Care Service bill as far as supporting a wider mental health approach. I know that in the recommendations from Feely, it says that there needs to be appropriate care provided for people, especially with complex needs. So it's alcohol, it's mental health, there's complex issues around the care. So I wonder if you have comments on whether the bill has sufficient clarity on how the mental health services and support can be provided in the overall framework, and then if you have any suggestions for what would need to be added.
Yeah, so I think currently, obviously, right now, looking at the bill, we don't actually know what mental health services are to be included. It's lacking kind of a definition, I suppose, of what actually is community mental health for people. And if people don't know what community mental health services are, how are they to know if they're meant to go to a national care service or an NHS? I think currently we're a bit concerned with the fact that if you are popping people, say, from the NHS into the National Care Service, so from that whole transitioning period from, say, if someone is in inpatient mental health care to then being put into the community, we know currently right now there's still people not having to stay in inpatient care in higher level security than actually required, because there's currently not those resources for the community for them to actually go into. And I think that's something in the bill that we need to look into and try and sort out, because if you've not got those resources in the community for a national care service for mental health, it's not actually going to work. We also know that people who have severe and enduring mental illness are also a lot more likely to have physical health problems as well. And they already have a lot of barriers to accessing those services. So again, if you have people, say, in a national care service under mental health, how are they going to access NHS services? It's already an additional barrier. So there's going to need to be very clear pathways and a very joint up approach between a national care service and an NHS. So I think we really need to look into basically seeing what actually is community health, what it is that people, what services people actually want to be within a national care service. I know, for example, during one of the original consultations, they were looking at possibly having mental health officers under a national care service. But that's a bit concerning, because they are the ones that are essentially providing that kind of medical opinion as to whether somebody should be detained or not. So they, to me, should be kind of a bit more impartial and maybe not necessarily sitting under a national care service. I think community link workers in a national care service are going to be really important in the whole kind of, not just with mental health, but talking about complex needs. Community link workers in GP practices aren't just able to link people to mental health services, but with anyone with additional needs, money advice, debt advice, alcohol services, everything. I think we're really going to have to ensure that community link workers play a very important role in the National Care Service.
Okay. I'm also interested in looking at, I have to find it in my papers actually, there's part of the bill that talks about helping support people with additional needs. Learning difficulty is one. Here it is here. So there is specific language about ensuring that individuals who have difficulty communicating in relation to speech and language or otherwise can receive information and express themselves in ways that best meets their individual needs. And so I circled the word otherwise and wrote mental health and dementia, for instance, there, because the bill, for me, might need further clarification on what otherwise means. So that's something I'd be interested to hear some feedback about, because the language in the bill, as a framework bill, should allow us to move forward with a co-design process. But I'm interested to hear if you think there needs to be some tweaking of some of the language in the bill to, I suppose, widen out what that kind of language like otherwise means.
No, definitely. That whole language on mental health is a key thing that's been coming up in the Scottish Mental Health Law Review report that's just been published. And there's this key need for people who have severe and enduring mental illness to be supported. So they're looking at this whole idea of a supporting decision maker and somebody to help. So I think that's something that definitely needs to be looked at in terms of language around the bill. There's definitely a lot of things that need kind of clarification. I know in terms of the around independent advocacy, it's where it's language like may instead of where we think, okay, this needs to happen around independent advocacy provision, and saying that it may happen. No, we need, it must happen. And I think especially for around people with mental health and complex needs, they need to have that assurance that it's actually going to move forward for them and going to happen.
And just kind of going back to the integration of services right now, you've highlighted that, you know, there are gaps where there is no on-care, so people are held in secure facilities instead of moving on. Would you envision that this National Care Services Bill would basically address the issues that you've highlighted so that there was a seamless approach? Because we've heard over the different sessions and in other sessions the importance of third sector or the independent sector in supporting people with mental health needs that don't necessarily need an acute stay in a mental health hospital. But would you see that the National Care Service Bill should be able to help support a seamless transition for people?
No, definitely. That would be one of our key hopes, I suppose, is that, one, the third sector has the funding and service provision to be able to help people, and so that we aren't having people stuck in inpatient services for no reason when they should be having and being able to access that support within the community. As I said earlier, all of our research shows that people want to be helped pre-crisis in their community. There's a kind of increase in demand for things like social prescribing and being able to access that support. And I do think when people think of kind of community support, they don't tend to think of severe and enduring mental illness. People automatically kind of think, oh, community support, it's not anybody that requires that really complex care, but there are ways that we can help people with severe and enduring mental illness in the community, for example, like our Stafford Centre in Broughton Street. So it's just ensuring that we all have those resources. There's no point in having a national care service if we're not going to have those resources.
Thanks. I might come back later as I'm thinking about other stuff.
Owen, I believe you want to come in on this.
Yes. Thanks, convener. Kira, you mentioned about stigma and mental health, and you said it's still a huge problem. People with mental health issues are trying to access services, and you gave quite a stark statistic at the beginning there. Do you think the National Care Service Bill is an opportunity to look at stigma and really get into that?
Definitely. I think under the aspect of the bill, there's a section on training, for example. And I think we need to give health and social care staff the training to be able to have those skills to speak and care for people that have particularly severe and enduring mental illness, because we know they're facing stigma at all aspects of their life. We would love to say that, I think with the pandemic, yes, people are probably being a lot more open to mental health, and a lot more people are definitely talking about it compared to how they used to. But particularly for severe and enduring mental illness, that's people with bipolar disorder, PTSD, psychosis, it's really stark and they're still experiencing it. And I would really recommend the committee, if you've not read the See Me report, please do read it. You will be shocked at some of those statistics. And we would recommend that, so under a National Care Service, all health and social care staff involved in that service should have to undergo some form of stigma training, particularly for people with mental health. I suppose that would include alcoholism and drugs as well, because it's not only mental health staff that should be having to have that training, it should be everybody, because you never know what point of contact somebody is going to access first. People can go on to a number of services, and not just public sector, but also the third sector as well. So it's important that that training is for everybody, and they're learning what actually happens to people with severe and enduring mental illness, what it is they're going through, the signs and the reasons they may act, how they're acting, just so people actually have an understanding. And as I said before, so it's like something for you, like self-directed support is one thing that the Alliance did a report a couple of years ago, and the stigma that people said they were receiving from when they were trying to, say, apply for self-directed support. And it was, there was one quote where a person said that because they had a mental illness, they were essentially being treated as if they were stupid, essentially. And they were like, no, I have a mental illness. That doesn't make me any different from you. So, yeah, really important that that training happens. And it also needs to be human rights based as well. So there really needs to be human rights training involved in that. And again, that's something that's picked up on in the Scottish Mental Health Law Review as well. So there's some key recommendations in there.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Now move on to talk about homelessness and drug and alcohol support. Questions led by Sandesh Gohani. Sandesh?
Thank you, Ellen. I'll be turning to you mainly for the questions I have. And my first one is, what impact might proposals for National Care Service have on the work of drug and alcohol partnerships? Do you think there's sufficient clarity in the bill, given that we know drug and alcohol services are not included in this bill?
We do not have sufficient clarity. Like I said earlier, I think though many of the problems that are faced by our alcohol and drug partnerships will not be addressed or do not have to be addressed by the National Care Service. They could be addressed now anyway. So, for instance, we've just been talking about stigma, or Ciara's just been talking about stigma, but we know that structural changes don't address this type of issue. What we need is relationships, we need resource, we need people to have the time to have therapeutic relationships with the people that they're providing care and support to. So all of these things don't come about because of a new structure. They come about because of resource and time and commitment. So that's something that we could be looking at right now, rather than waiting for the National Care Service to come along and potentially have some impact on these things. But we don't need it to do these things. But on the other hand, it could also put at risk that time, resource, etc., that we need in order to be able to address properly the needs of people with alcohol and I'm here talking about alcohol use problems, but obviously our evidence was joint with other organisations who have also got an interest in drugs. We were all singing from the same hymn sheet on this. It's not a matter of the National Care Service coming along and meeting the needs of these people. We could do that now with the setup that we've got now if we put the resource in place.
Can I just pick up something that you said just there? You said put at risk. Could you explain that, please?
Well, there's a real risk that as I said earlier, I guess, that the strategic view is absorbed in what the National Care Service is going to mean. It's going to take, obviously, at this point in time, we've got framework legislation. There's going to be so much effort and resource required to actually flesh that out in terms of what it's going to mean in practice. So it's every population in Scotland is potentially going to have to be involved in shaping that, which is good from a co-production perspective, but from the perspective of the urgency of the situation we're in now, means that we're going to be, it could serve as a potential distraction from what we could be working on now to put in place to meet the needs of people who are on the ground. And we know that there's examples of great practice across Scotland. So I've mentioned the Health Committee in a previous evidence session, the work that's done in Aberdeen with the Aberdeen Integrated Alcohol Service, which genuinely brings together health, care and the third sector and puts the person with the alcohol problem at the centre. They're assigned an appropriate key worker who can have a really strong relationship with that person and then bring all the services that are needed to help support that person, whether it's housing, social security, justice, all of these come together and actually genuinely support that person at the centre. So that can happen now with the structures that we've got now, and it's so we don't need the National Care Service to do this.
Okay, and so yeah, time and resource are the two key asks from what you're saying, which I suppose most people would be wanting. But when it comes to time and resource, what would be the best way of being able to put that in place for people with, well, in your case, alcohol dependency? And my follow-up question will be very much based upon what you just said about Aberdeen as a good example of it. And how do we see good examples with alcohol being rolled out across the country?
On what's needed now in terms of resource and time, I think it's impossible to say because there has not been a needs assessment of alcohol use disorder and alcohol problems in Scotland for a good 10-15 years. So we simply don't know the scale of the problem. At that point, though, when the last needs assessment was carried out, it was estimated that about one in four people who would be in need of some sort of service from an alcohol service, about one in four were receiving some that kind of service. We know, though, that since then we've seen, in the last 2 years, we've seen the number of people dying from alcohol increase. Yet over that time, over the last 6 to 10 years, we've seen the number of people with alcohol problems accessing treatment and support go down. So we know that need is potentially static, if not going up, but the number of people accessing support has gone down. So what we need now is a proper needs assessment and then work out what services we need to put in place. And that would really be a stepped approach. So we'd be talking about all the different types of services from a quite low intensity input right through to, say, high intensity rehabilitation and all the steps in between, some of which are more generic and some of which are much more specialist. And that's what we need to see put in place.
Thank you.
Emma, you had a very quick follow-up on something that that Eleanor just said.
Yeah, so Eleanor, you said that some work can be done now rather than waiting for a bill. So just to and tackling stigma would be one thing. So it's just to highlight, I have a meeting with Angela Constance next week to talk about education for all healthcare personnel, so not just folk that work in alcohol and drugs, to tackle stigma, basically, because what Kira was saying was it's not just for folk that work in mental health that need mental health training. So my short issue is that that work will be going forward now because I'm meeting Angela next week to talk about tackling stigma. But the bill has a section about training. So would that be welcome to then say that let's embed the training that's required? It's in the bill, and that means that the whoever takes the training forward is responsible to make sure that everybody gets the education that's required.
Yes, I think that would be a good opportunity, and I think it's really important because it's something that has been talked about for a number of years. So in the alcohol framework for Scotland, it's very clear that there should be a no wrong door approach, so that wherever somebody with an alcohol problem pops up in our health and care system, they should then be signposted or supported to easily get the treatment and support that they need. And the stigma, but that's in reality not necessarily happening. So we know that stigma is one of those barriers. And so training and better education and awareness around alcohol problems would be very welcome across the whole of the health and care workforce. And we're talking here from receptionists through to consultants and absolutely everybody involved in care and support.
Okay, thanks.
The issue here is you've pointed to a number of the things that should be happening on the ground. There's already regulations, there's already policy in that area, but there's an implementation gap.
Yeah.
And also there's a geographical differentiation around the country where good practice isn't being shared across the country. Is that really the opportunity for a national care service to have that? You know, to close that implementation gap and to actually have a consistency across the country?
It's definitely an opportunity of the National Care Service. But I suppose we've got the National Care Service and then the local boards who would actually be in charge of commissioning the services. So it's how that actually works in reality, the relationship between those local areas and any sort of national standards or whatever may be taken forward. And there's going to be alcohol treatment guidance. It's been long awaited. It's from the UK government, which we then hope to filter through to services in Scotland. So if that alcohol treatment guidance, for instance, was used as a benchmark for the provision of services for people with alcohol problems in Scotland, and then actually monitored and potentially standards were put in place to ensure that it was actually delivered in the same way that MAT, medically assisted treatment standards, have been put in place for drugs. If we had something similar put in place for alcohol, then we could see quite a big difference within the structures of the National Care Service.
Thank you. I'm going to hand over to Gillian Mackay. Gillian?
Thanks, Convener. What opportunities are there for the Bill to improve support and treatment for people who experience problematic drug or alcohol use? And what changes would the panel like to see to the Bill to ensure that these are realised? And could I go to Eleanor Jane first, please?
I think the changes that we need within the bill are that we need the detail. There's just not the detail right now to be able to have any meaningful discussion of what services would look like under the National Care Service. And like I said earlier, we don't necessarily need the National Care Service in order to be able to make those improvements that we need to see now. So I think that the fundamental question for the committee is, I guess, whether you're prepared to take at face value that what the bill proposes, and then that anything that emerges in secondary legislation that comes from co-design will then actually, you'll have the opportunity to scrutinise that and to actually see what it's likely to mean in practice. And I think that's a problem with the bill as it currently sits, is that it's very difficult for me to be able to say what it's likely to mean in practice and for you to have the opportunity to scrutinise it.
Gillian?
And thanks. And further to Emma Harper's question just there about reducing stigma, are there, beyond the training piece, do you see opportunities within the bill or to reduce stigma surrounding problematic drug or alcohol use within social care services?
Yes, one of the reasons that when the Scottish Government consulted originally on the National Care Service, that we came down in favour of including alcohol and drug services within anything that emerged within the National Care Service is very much because of the stigma that people with alcohol and drug problems experience on a daily basis, whether it's in their day-to-day lives or whether it's when it comes to accessing services. And so by keeping alcohol and drug services separate from the National Care Service, we risk further stigmatising this group of people, because they'd be the only group of people effectively who'd be kept separate. So from a sort of the principle of trying to undo some of the stigma that people experience, it is important that people with alcohol and drug problems are included within National Care Service. So that's one way of addressing stigma, but it certainly isn't the only way. Obviously, training is really important, but there's so much work that needs to be done within our communities at a very sort of grassroots, local level to address stigma.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Gillian. Now move on to focus on palliative care and long-term conditions. Questions led by Tess White.
Thank you. So my question's to Mark Hazelwood. So I've just got one key question, Mark. So the SPPC have said that the principles set out in the bill don't take account of people who still need care but have no hope or expectation of a cure. So in your opinion, what consequences could this have for these patients if the issue is not addressed? Thank you.
Thank you. And you're right. In my response, we highlighted some, particularly in the section on the principles of the National Care Service, where the language doesn't really encompass the circumstances of people approaching the end of life and their detailed examples and suggested rewordings. So the reason this isn't just about wordsmithing or semantics is that we have a bill here which is high level. It's an enabling framework. Now, it's a lot of detail to work through further down, and it's really important that as the thinking is done on the detail of the secondary legislation, that the situation and the circumstances of people approaching the end of life are very clearly signalled as a major concern of this service. I've already started by giving statistics which show that the needs of people approaching the end of life are an absolutely huge part of what this National Care Service is supposed to deliver. So language really does matter, and I'll give you two examples of what can happen when the language, where this issue gets overlooked. So The government published alongside, in the context of the publication of the bill, four very detailed evidence papers about the demographics of the Scottish population, the demographics of people who use social care services, and survey work on the experiences of people who use social care services. And nowhere in those four papers of detailed evidence was there any reference to house and end-of-life care and the people of needs with these circumstances. So it's something that I've worked in this field now for 13 years, and we currently see this phase of life overlooked in policy. I think it's partly a psychological thing. It's partly because we're not a specific specialty. People have all sorts of different medical conditions that can put them at this stage of life. So it's often omitted. And for that reason, it's really, really important that the principles are worded in a way that makes it clear that palliative and end-of-life care is part of the central mission of this service. The other example of policy omission is the current cancer strategy, which I know is being reviewed and renewed. The current cancer strategy, despite the fact that 50% of people who are diagnosed with cancer will not survive beyond 5 years, has no reference to palliative and end-of-life care. So we absolutely have to stop that sort of omission happening in future by signalling very clearly this phase of life in the bill, in the principles. And we believe that palliative and end-of-life care should be explicitly woven through the bill and through the secondary legislation when we come on to the charter and the arrangements around strategic commissioning at national and local level.
Just one follow-up. Mark, so you argue that, so you say it's a big omission, but you argue that people approaching the end of life are by far the biggest single group of people receiving social care. Just a comment on that would be helpful.
Yeah. So if you look at how many people who are in care homes for older people in Scotland, there are around 33,000 people. That's more beds than in the NHS. The majority of those people are in the last 18 months of life. Probably 70% plus of those people have dementia. These are all people with palliative and end-of-life care needs. Again, if you look at people in receipt of care at home, I think 60,000 people each week providing care home support. And again, the majority of those are frail elderly people with palliative and end-of-life care. Absolutely central. And aside from the personal impact on individuals and families, which we've heard about this morning, we have to think also about the resource implications. So this is an area of support where there's a large proportion of the health and social care budget used to support people in this way, but it's not really done on a planned way. The responses that people receive, as we've heard this morning, tend to be fragmented and reactive. And what we need to see, and you know, we hope this is one of the things that the bill can do, is to support a population health approach to palliative and end-of-life care, where we look at the needs across the population, we look at all the resource that's within the system, and again, we have to look at the health and the social care system together, and we establish a locus of responsibility and accountability at local level for planning and integrating the services. And I think really crucially, understanding what the outcomes and experiences are for people in receipt of those services. This committee, I think in 2015, did an inquiry into palliative and end-of-life care. And one of the reports that you commissioned was to understand how good palliative and end-of-life care was in Scotland and look at what measurement and data was available. And I still can't answer that question because we haven't made sufficient progress. So the Health and Care Experience Survey, for example, which informs a lot of the integration indicators, excludes people towards the end of life. It's done for, I think, well-meaning reasons, and obviously this is a sensitive area. But there are ways in which we can systematically gather the experiences of people towards the end of life. And we really should be doing that because we're spending a lot of money in this area and we need to know what's being delivered by the system.
Thank you. Stephanie, you have some questions on this area?
Yeah,
Thanks very much, Convener. My question is also for Mark, and can I just say as well, I think palliative care brings so much comfort and so much reassurance for families. It's absolutely priceless. I wanted to ask you about how well are things working just now as far as keeping people at home as much as possible? You'd spoken earlier on as well about one in three hospital beds being used by someone in their last year of life, about increased admissions and discharges as well. So really, how can we look at improving that? How can the National Care Service help with that? And I'm wondering as well, is being able to step up and step down care at a local level very quickly one of the important factors in that?
Okay, thank you. It's really important to say that quite often it's the right thing for somebody to be admitted to hospital towards the end of life. And hospital care is a really important part of palliative and end of life care for people towards the end of life. So it's absolutely, we shouldn't just be aiming to avoid admissions, because many of those admissions will be entirely the right thing for that person. So I think what we need to think about, and Susan started by talking about responsiveness of social care services. So sometimes people are admitted because we don't have, really because we don't have the right resource within the community. Well, there's the right resource, but it can't be mobilised quickly enough. So I do think that that's an area where we absolutely need to do better. And I think also at the moment, sometimes with workforce issues, it's just not possible to provide the level of support that somebody may need to stay at home when they want to stay at home. I've just had a bit of a rant about the lack of measurement about experiences. So I can't tell you exactly how well it's working or how well it isn't. And that is a big problem. I should be able to sit here and give you some good data on people's experiences and some idea of the level of emissions that perhaps didn't need to take place and could have been avoided. But I can't get you those figures. But clearly, with the financial and workforce pressures that are on the system, I don't think it's going in the right direction at the moment.
Susan would like to come in, Stephanie. Can I bring Susan in?
Yep, and then I'll do a wee quick follow-up as well, if that's okay.
Just really to add to what Mark was saying, that we have examples of people who effectively, you know, people with MND who, you know, obviously have a limited life expectancy, being stuck in hospital for and being well enough to leave, but are unable to leave for no other reason than they can't have enough care at home, and they're actually being prevented from leaving because the local care provider can't provide those care workers for them. And that's hugely problematic and has a massive impact on not just that person but on their families, because those precious months that they have with that person, they want to have them at home. So that can be a real problem. Similarly, which hasn't been touched on, is the some people, because of the lack of care at home provision, some people are finding that they have no alternative but to go into a care home, when they would actually much rather be at home with their families and have that potentially more intensive care at home than maybe is the norm and that most companies are set up to provide. But to have that intensity of care at home available to them could make a huge difference, because they do want to spend their final months at home with their loved ones rather than being in a care home, if that is not where they choose. For some people, they want to be, but if they do not want to be in a care home and they do not want to be stuck in hospital, then a strong care at home workforce is really, really essential.
And I couldn't agree more. I think most people will feel exactly the same, Susan. So I suppose my question for both yourself and Mark is, what would you like to see in the bill to support this? Is there anything specific that you would like to see in there?
For myself, I guess it's what Eleanor said, just more detail, because it's just not there in any way, shape or form. And I do understand that, you know, this is a framework bill and, you know, the government are saying that they want co-design and co-production, but I don't personally think that having more detail in a bill prevents co-design or co-production. I think the two can happen.
So could you give us a couple of examples of the type of detail that you're talking about then that you'd like to see there?
Well, I think there could be a lot more details. Where would you start? In terms of workforce, we would like to see... I think there needs to be detail around... There needs to be more recognition of terminal illness, as Mark said, and the needs of people with terminal illness and the fact that they need these increased levels of care, and it needs to be really responsive because they are a group of people that have definite needs, and that isn't recognised at all. So the needs of people with terminal illness are really, really important. We would like to see more detail on the workforce, that you're going to have a workforce that is paid appropriately, trained appropriately and supported and valued. And I think, this is an ambitious piece of legislation. I think there's a real ambitious strategy needed to get the workforce that is essential. So we'd like to... I could go on forever, but that's maybe what to start with. Thank you.
I don't know if Mark has anything to add to that. Mark?
Yes. Right, I do. It's a framework bill, so if it's still going to be a framework bill and not morph into something else, we would certainly like to see changes to the principles set out in the bill so that it clearly encompasses the end of life along with other phases of life, and we've suggested wording about how that could be done. I think that we would also like to see a reference to palliative end-of-life care and the need to take a population health approach at local level in strategic planning and commissioning. And we certainly would like to see that. I think in terms of if we started to move away from, thinking about what ought to be in the bill or the sort of detail that we need to see, one thing that we've not really touched on is that the bill gives powers to grant to the care boards oversight and responsibility for community health services. There's really only a couple of references to that in the legislation. That's absolutely huge. I understand that co-production is about putting the flesh on the bones. But it would be helpful to know what skeleton we've got. Is that a giraffe or an elephant, and how many legs has it got? And I think that example of the community health services, where is it going to sit? That's a pretty fundamental question for our health and social care services. In terms of palliative end-of-life care, at the moment, the statutory responsibility for commissioning palliative end-of-life care lies with the IJBs. And that is not just about the community health services, but they also have responsibility for swathes of unscheduled hospital care activity. I've mentioned a couple of times the number of people in hospital who are receiving end-of-life care. So it would be helpful, I think, to get some sort of steer about where those community health services are going to sit in the new world when we have the National Care Service, and I'm particularly concerned about where palliative and end-of-life care will sit, and whether there'll be a kind of broad move across from the responsibilities of the IJB to the care board, or I don't know whether the government has something else envisaged, but it would be helpful to get a steer about what the thinking is on that. And I think what we'd be looking for within whatever structural solutions is there are things which support integrated working, because people don't really care whether it's a social care service or a healthcare service, they just want the right service. So we want a framework where that can be delivered and where there is commissioning that recognises that for palliative and end-of-life care, you have the NHS involved, you have third sector organisations like Motor Neurone Disease that Susan's representing, Marie Curie, Macmillan, all the voluntary hospices providing huge amounts of specialist palliative care. And you also have the independent sector, the main providers of care homes and care at home services. So we need commissioning processes which support and enable integrated and collaborative working, and which, you know, there's references to ethical commissioning. We need to make sure that there's financial sustainability for organisations such as the voluntary hospices.
You can move on to more discussion on co-design, but also self-directed support. Questions from Evelyn Tweed. Evelyn?
Thanks, Convener. Yes, some of the answers have been quite useful for the next set of questions. But I'm really interested in how can we make sure in the co-design process that everyone has a say, including those with maybe communication difficulties, reduced agency? How can we make sure that everyone has the opportunity to shape the bill? And I would like to ask Mark, but if anyone else would like to come in, that would be great. Thank you.
Okay, so there are particular practical and ethical issues around involving people approaching the end of life. But I think we really have to avoid paternalism here, because people are often keen to tell their stories and to share their experiences. So there are ways that which we can go about supporting that. It will require time and resource to do it. I think the other thing that we mustn't overlook is we actually know quite a lot already through some excellent qualitative research, a lot of which done at Edinburgh University. They've done a whole series of qualitative interviews with people approaching the end of life, their carers, and often triangulated with care professionals as well. So we should be feeding into the co-design process what we already know from having previously asked people with these experiences. I don't think we should always go back and start with a fresh sheet of paper when we have already been told what the answers are. And very often the issue is that we haven't listened to those answers, or we haven't done enough to deliver what people want. So I think it's a mixture. I think we need to draw on that existing research and evidence, and also sensitively and supportively ask people themselves, and also involved bereaved carers of people who've been on the journey with their loved ones, who are often keen to share their stories, the good things and the bad things, so it can certainly be done.
In terms of people who use alcohol and drug services, I think it's really important that we don't overlook the wider communities and families around those people, because that's really important to people's recovery, is that everyone involved in their lives gets the support that they need. So it's really important that everybody who's involved, whether it's primarily or by degree removed, everyone is involved in that co-production. We do have a new, I can't remember the exact title, but national collaborative that's focused on developing or sort of co-producing and co-designing services, or looking at issues collaboratively between people who use services and healthcare professionals and others involved in that service provision. So there is something set up under Professor Alan Miller that should be able to contribute towards co-design here. But I do think it's really important to involve everybody, including families.
Kira?
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, I'll bring Susan and then Kira.
Thank you. Yes, it was interesting that you actually highlighted people that have speech problems, and that, of course, includes many people with MND who lose their speech as part of their illness, and their dexterity in their fingers as well, which can mean that they can actually not be able to use, they can't type, for example, as well. So it's really important that people with illnesses like MND are enabled as much as possible to contribute through the various methods, lived experience panels, for example. One of the things that I would say in terms of the lived experience panels is a concern that with an illness like MND, the intensity of the illness, not just in terms of the disability that person's experiencing, but the intensity of caring for somebody with that illness, which basically, as Mark touched on earlier, is a 24/7 role, incredibly draining for the carer. So actually enabling people that have these huge caring responsibilities to contribute as well, and just having that awareness, you know, that these people aren't getting left out because they just don't have the ability, you know, capacity to contribute. So really being quite creative and person-centred in terms of enabling people to contribute as well, and working with charities like ourselves who have that contact and have already got that feedback, like Mark highlighted, and we have lots of input and quotes from people from work that we have done that could be very helpful. And also, as he highlighted, using bereaved carers as well. So I think it's just having that awareness that there's people who are extremely disabled and people with very intensive care demands on their lives, that it become that any interaction with people is really, really flexible and open and inclusive.
Yes, so I think particularly for people with severe and enduring mental illness, it kind of needs to be noted that, I suppose there's another way to put it, then they can have good days and bad days. And I have my own experience from conducting some focus groups with some of our service users in different services, where one day you'll go in and they're having a great day, they're really eager to participate and they want to participate, but maybe when the time comes, something's happened, they're not necessarily in the headspace to actually contribute then. And I think it's important to kind of have that, I suppose, that sense of flexibility. So say if somebody has agreed to participate, that say that day they can't, they are able to come back and do that. I've also noticed a lot of the kind of co-design work so far, I know there's obviously a lot more to come, it's just the beginning, but anything so far in the National Care Service has very much been online as well, which I'm hoping will kind of change with everything moving forward. But a lot of people with severe and enduring mental illness, if you look at research, are actually digitally excluded as well, and they require support. So being able to maybe do that in person if they prefer, and allowing them to have somebody to come along with them, again, kind of going back to the Scottish Mental Health Law Review and having that kind of supporter with somebody who is trained not to interfere, I suppose, with their response, but it's just there to help them get their opinions across. And that's also the same, as I said, we support a lot of people in remote and rural Scotland, and I think it's really important to make sure that we're not just focusing on the central belt here or those kind of main areas that we think are rural, like such as Inverness, but actually going properly into those remote and rural areas of Scotland and ensuring that everyone and their experiences are really represented during this co-design process.
Thank you. Evelyn, if you get anything else you want to ask, or will I move on?
I've got one more, convener.
Sure.
And again, to Mark first, but if anybody else wants to come in, please do. What can we learn from self-directed support implementation, and what do you want to see this bill do differently?
So to be honest, that's not an area I know a huge amount about, and I think that may be in part because often people approach the end of their life, their need for social care maybe for quite a short period. And some of what I've heard is that some of the current processes around setting up and managing self-directed support are quite burdensome for people in terms of the administrative stuff that needs to be done, and it can be quite slow. And so often it is not something that people find an attractive proposition, particularly when their time is short. But I would hand on to others who probably have more experience in that area, to be honest.
Thank you. We've actually found self-directed support to really work quite well for people with MND. It gives people that person-centeredness, and they're able to develop their own care in the way that they would like. Sometimes people with MND can be put off by others. You don't really want to bother with this, it'd be too much work for you, but actually, you know, done well, it can actually be really quite effective. So we've got, you know, we do have examples of people being able to employ a family member to do nighttime care, enabling the full-time carer to get sleep. which has worked really well for that family. We have another example of a family in the north of Scotland who have been able to use enhanced payments through self-direct support to actually get a care worker to provide support and the right skill level that is really needed for MND who's got the training and, you know, what to offer. Obviously, it's more difficult to recruit people to do for SDS in the north of Scotland, but she was unable to pay that little bit extra through the system, and she you know, it's working incredibly well for her to have that support, the support that she needs when she needs it to support her and her family. So it's actually worked incredibly well for her. So it can work really well. It just needs people just need enabled and supported to use it properly, I think, and not be put off maybe potentially unnecessarily to use it, because it can really work well for people.
Yeah. So we know from the Alliance's My Support, My Choice research, the uptake kind of for people with mental health and self-directed support is actually quite low, surprisingly. But from the research, we see that the people that do receive it are finding that it's really improving their experience of social care. There's some examples of some service users I've spoken to from some of our services who are on self-directed support, and they like the fact it allows them to get out of the house. I've had carers. We also support carers of people who support someone with severe enduring mental illness, and they've said how it's really helped them, and they see the change in the person and how it's really improved their life. However, there's still a lot of kind of barriers to access for self-directed support for people with mental health. So when they're, say, going through their options, they're not actually being told the four options that they can have, and they're just kind of being told, oh, yeah, to have this one. So they're not being able to essentially make an informed choice about the support they're receiving and the budgets and all of that. So we really need to ensure that people with poor mental health have that same access and an equal access and informed choice to self-directed support. We also, there's no data that indicates that a specific option is chosen for people with poor mental health. So it'd be great if something, we could have something in the bill so we can actually monitor and see the type, gather data on what options people with poor mental health are having, and also through that getting different demographics, protected characteristics, just so we can see the type of support that people are actually receiving through that.
That seems like a good note to move on to a final theme on evaluation, monitoring and sequencing, and questions led by Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'll go to Mark first again, because he's actually mentioned a couple of times as well around having that data there to be able to make decisions going forward. But I realise that, you know, we've got a really wide range of different experiences here, different type of people with different challenges, and that lived experience is something that we've always spoken about being very, very central to the National Care Service. So across the board, what should we be looking to measure, and how do we measure it? So, I mean, right across the board for different people in different situations, what are those things that really matter that we should be putting the focus on? Thank you.
Mark, initially.
Yes.
Yeah, but we, you know, we have quite a lot of data about activity. So there's been real progress in terms of linking data, so we can see where people were at different parts of their journey towards the end of life. A really big gap is understanding people's experience of care and how far where they ended up kind of reflected their own wishes and preferences. So, you know, that's really what matters. We have this huge complex system, but we don't have a way of asking people, you know, how was it for you? We ask what matters to you. We don't ask how was it for you, particularly in this phase of life, which is universal. We're all going to go there. So that's a huge gap. And there are, you know, there are complexities in populating that gap, but there are things that we can do. Northern Ireland, England and Wales, they've been doing a national audit on care at the end of life. That's a model that could be adapted and used in Scotland. There has been a piloting of a national survey of bereaved carers. And they act as a proxy for the person whose life has ended, but report back on what that person experienced and how it matched with their preferences. We recently produced a report which looked at a number of things about how to improve palliative and end-of-life care. And there's a whole chapter in there about how to measure and understand and learn from people's experiences. I'd be very happy to write to the committee and send you that to cover the opportunities and the detail and some of the challenges that are involved. Definitely doable, though. It just needs will at national and local level and probably a bit of resource as well.
Thank you, Mark.
When it comes to alcohol and drug treatments, I think it's important to take a step back because the role of alcohol and drugs partnerships isn't purely the commissioning of services. It's also a public health role, and it's about prevention of alcohol and drug harms as well. This is notoriously hard to measure and is very is taken forward in very different ways in local areas. But I think it's really important that we, whatever is measured or evaluated as a part of the National Care Service, it's not purely services, it's thinking about trying to prevent some of those problems and harms occurring in the first place, and a way to measure them would be great. One of the challenges that we have is that we don't know the number of people in Scotland who do have an alcohol or drug problem. So, specifically on alcohol, it'd be really helpful to have a starting point now and to actually assess a level of alcohol use disorder, for instance, that there is across Scotland. And then we could actually start looking at, in the longer term, measuring that to see how much impact services are having, and also that public health element is having as well on reducing that kind of harm. At this point in time, we do have an alcohol treatment target, which measures how many people are seen within a certain time frame after being referred to an alcohol service. That's a very crude measure and it's interpreted differently in every local area as to what it means as well. So it could mean that it's assumed that person is then starting on their treatment journey, but it could be that they've basically been triaged and assessed, yes, they do need treatment, but then put on another list to actually access that treatment. So that treatment target at this point in time isn't particularly helpful, but there is going to be a group set up by the Scottish Government to review that and put in place a more meaningful target around alcohol treatment, which should be really helpful and should sit alongside, as I mentioned earlier, the alcohol treatment guidance, which we're expecting in the course of the next few months.
So just to wind back a little bit there, how do we ensure that those receiving support are actually kept central to the evaluations that we're looking at with the National Performance Framework? Is that something that would actually be helpful and be part of it, in your view?
There is what's called DAISY, and it's Drugs Alcohol Information System, I think it stands for, which is a newish system that's been set up within Public Health Scotland, which means that everybody who enters an alcohol or drug service has data collected on them. So establishing whether that system is a good way to then evaluate outcomes would be, I think, rather than reinventing the wheel, to make sure that system works to assess outcomes for people who enter services would be really, really helpful. But actually making sure that works in practice, data is being entered into it by all our partners across Scotland, would be really helpful, because I'm not sure if that's happening at this point in time.
Okay, thank you.
Time for one final question from Sandesh Gohani, and then we must break.
Thank you. Susan, I'd like to ask you, but I'm sure it's open for anyone else who would like to answer. We've heard a lot about the co-design process, and I wanted to ask what evaluation safeguards and transparency you feel we should have in primary legislation before we start the co-design process to review what is produced by the Scottish Government.
So looking for what's that, so what should be included on the bill?
Yes.
Yes. I guess it's just what I kind of touched on earlier. I mean, we would like to see mention, as I highlighted, a mention of how the government is going to secure the workforce that is needed on the face of the bill. What's the strategy for that? What's the plan for that? And when I'm talking about it, I'm really talking about social care, fundamentally social care, because that is what people with MND are using and not experiencing what they should. We would like to see a primary legislation. We'd like to see terminal illness as a group. We would like to see mention of fast tracking. We'd like to see mention of planning, anticipatory care planning. Now, when you mention co-design, are you talking about how would I wasn't quite sure about when you were talking about primary legislation and co-design, the connection between those two in your question.
So primary legislation is sort of the framework bill,
yeah.
And the co-design is where we're going to see the implementation happen,
yes.
and what the plans are. So my question really was what we need to see on that framework bill,
yes.
To be able to effectively evaluate what we get after the co-design process, because the bill will be passed or not passed before the co-design process.
Yes. I mean, in terms of the evaluation, I mean, the key things that I would like to really, the key things that need to be considered for evaluation are people getting what they were, are people receiving the care that they were assessed as needing? So are people getting the care packages that they were assessed as needing? Is that being delivered for them? The regularity, one of the key issues for us is the regularity of care workers. I was speaking to somebody just the other day there whose mum has had 19 different care workers in 2 months. Times of visits, you know, we've got people getting tucked in at 6 and 7 o'clock at night, and some people not being able to use, some care workers not being able to use equipment that somebody's been given. So these are huge things. They make a huge difference to the experience of people with MND. So these kind of things need to be assessed. And I think the only way that they can be effectively assessed is if people with lived experience, be that people with illness, bereaved carers, have the opportunity to co-design at the beginning, and to be a very, very key part of the evaluation process at the end, because all of these things are utterly critical in terms of assessing whether the National Care Service is working or not in terms of its impact on people in their day-to-day lives. So we would like to see as much of that in the bill as possible. We want to see, as I say, fast-tracking, planning, a care service, a workforce that is trained, supported, valued and paid appropriately, so that people want to work in this sector, so that they're not leaving it in hordes to go and work in a supermarket that's just popped up in a local community. That it's really that's what people want to do when they leave school. It really, you know, we want to see that as well. So, as much of that detail on the bill, and as I said earlier, I don't think that prevents co-design and co-production. I don't think that amount of detail prevents co-design production. We saw the Social Security Bill. We worked very closely with Marie Curie to ensure that fast-tracking, a fair definition of fast-tracking, was included in the bill. It was also supposed to be initially a sort of framework bill. We worked closely with Marie Curie to make sure that there was a fair definition of fast-tracking on the bill. And there has been loads of co-design and loads of effective co-production since that period. We've been working for years with the CMO's office, with the Scottish Government to co-produce guidance and various implementation practices after that. So I think there is potential for a lot more detail. We would like to see these key things on the bill, and I don't think it precludes co-design thereafter.
Thank you.
I've run out of time. I want to thank four of you for the time this morning, and if there's anything that we want to follow up on, maybe if there hasn't been an opportunity, because that 90 minutes goes past incredibly fast, we'll write to you, and you, we'd certainly include
what your responses are in our report. So we're going to stop for 10 minutes before our next panel comes on. Thank you.
ago. Welcome back, everyone. We now move on to our second evidence session on the National Care Service Bill. And I'm delighted to say we've got everyone in person, which is a bit of a treat. I don't have to be looking at a screen as well as your faces here. I welcome Alison Leach and Cathy Russell from Care Homes Relative Scotland. Dr. Kendi Manji, the Head of Dementia for Age Scotland's About Dementia Project. Henry Simmons, the Chief Executive for Alzheimer's Scotland. And Adam Sakura, the Head of Policy and Communications for Age Scotland. Welcome to you all. As has become my own tradition in these scrutiny sessions, I'm asking people what their hopes are for the National Care Service Bill as it stands, what their hopes are for the National Care Service as it is going to be in terms of addressing maybe some of the unmet need that we've maybe experienced. And I maybe just go around everyone. And as I always say in these situations, I do ask everyone, I do a bit of a round robin with everyone, but not every member is going to have that luxury or else we would quickly run out of time. So my members will be directing their questions to you. But Alison, if I can come to you first.
I've been involved in my mum's care for over 10 years now, from keeping her at home. She was diagnosed with dementia at the age of 60. So I've been through the whole process of care at home, care packages, day centres, and then a move into the care home. And I suppose the purpose of being here today is really the importance of Anne's Law in the National Care Service Bill, because myself and the other core members of Care Home Relative Scotland lived with the horrors of the pandemic and being separated from our loved ones. And I would just really like to make it noted that it isn't just older people in care homes, there's a whole range of ages in care. And we started out as five daughters and a mother, ranging from Holly, from 37, to Alice, who's 98. So it's just to bear that in mind, there's a whole range of ages and conditions living in care homes that what we lived through for the last 2.5 years should never be allowed to happen again.
OK, thank you. Cathy?
Hi. As well as being on the involved with Care Home Relatives Group, I'm also on the Social Covenant Steering Group. And I think, like the rest of Scotland, everyone that's interested in social care, I was absolutely delighted when I seen the Feely report. I thought it was a great report, a great read. I think the bill, in a way, doesn't live up to that because it's all about structure, and it's hard to get across the emotion of what was behind Feely through the bill. And there's things, I have fears that there are things missing in the bill, like the terrible situation facing an awful lot of self-funders in care homes at the moment. There's 10,000, and they are not getting the money, they might get personal care allowance. That covers them for about 2 days a month in a care home. The rest of it, they're having to sell their homes to pay for their care. So there's an awful lot wrong with the system. And the problem I have, and I think part of the National Covenant Steering Group was a recognition by Feely that we needed this nationwide drive and this nationwide support to improve care. But what the bill does is it's all about white-collar jobs. It's all about planning and commissioning and all of these things. And it's a structure which seems very similar to the structure we have at the moment, only with a minister in charge and then a National Care Service Board. So I think what we really need is, what we'd really love to see is something which really is going to really improve self-directed support, do an awful lot more for people in that front line of care, and do an awful lot more to attract people into the industry and to really enjoy being really empathic, helpful care workers.
Thank you. Henry?
Yeah, thanks for being there. So in terms of the National Care Service, our view is that the government made dementia a priority in 2007. Since 2010, we've had three consecutive national dementia strategies. There are probably at least 35, 40 recommendations and commitments that we've made in each of the national dementia strategies. And the policies, we would say, have been great. They've been fantastic. They've been co-produced. They've been really well thought through, heralded as world-leading. But the implementation has been incredibly difficult. And I think that the problem there was identified by Derek Feely in the report in terms of that, the transference from a national strategy, national agreements, national commitments into local delivery. So we've been, for 12 years, trying really hard to work with government and local partners to get some of the basics of the strategies put in place. And we still aren't there today. So, I mean, we don't have prevention, diagnosis, post-diagnostic support, integrated care, advanced care, models and pathways that have all been agreed to and tested. We don't have anywhere that really is implementing all of that. And there's a real breakdown between the national aspirations and local delivery. Now, there are many reasons for that. We might get into that later on. But that for us, makes it quite appealing when someone talks about a national care service to move forward. When we look at the detail of the bill, I think I would agree with some of what's been said already, that there are issues and difficulties and things that need to be panned out. But what we would aspire to is the challenge that we've been significantly concerned about and campaigning about now for a number of years is the inequality that people who progress to advanced dementia experience within our care system. And what that really means is that when someone perhaps enters a care home, their needs will progress because it's a progressive brain disease, and their needs will change, and they invariably become healthcare needs. And if you imagine any person that you've seen with a terminal condition at end of life stages, that's what someone living with dementia will end up living their experience like within a care home. And it's nothing but healthcare needs that are required. I mean, they can't walk, they can't feed, they need help toileting, they need help with everything. And in a sense, you can't call that social care, but we still charge people about £1,000 to £1,200 per week for that. And we would like a definition of advanced dementia and indeed the opportunity for people to have an assessment so that their needs are paid for and covered by the NHS. Now that's, in our opinion, still a duty in the NHS. And with the integration in the bill, we've got to get that interface right between what is healthcare and what is social care and what's free at the point of delivery and how that's been assessed. So we have big aspirations for the bill going forward on that basis, Convener.
Yeah, thank you, very helpful. Can I go to Dr. Manji?
Thank you very much, Convener. I think we absolutely welcome the principles of the bill and the vision that has been stated. I think the commitment to co-design is absolutely welcome and long overdue. I am concerned, and we as an organisation are concerned about some of the lack of detail within the bill. Absolutely recognise that there is a balance to be had when it comes to co-production, but sometimes it is useful to have more than a very broad framework to give people a key in to what it is that they want to express and what needs to happen and what needs to change. I think there's a real sense of urgency about this piece of work. We're now 2 years since Feely took his evidence, and we are not very much further forward in terms of seeing those changes that we want to see implemented. I think in terms of the Charter of Rights, absolutely fantastic to have that ingrained within the bill. But a lot of the teeth will be coming from the secondary legislation. And I think there is a need to future-proof the legislation. Absolutely, the aspirations within that policy memorandum are what we would like to see in terms of a national care service. But how do we ensure that that is what we get if it is not within the primary legislation? I think there are significant gaps in implementation that haven't been addressed, and I think with a very structural and process-driven bill, we miss the opportunity. We've seen this happen time and again with the introduction of self-directed support and with integration, where there has not been enough investment in time, in skills, in resource, in bringing about genuine culture change within the people who are implementing legislation, that doesn't work. So for me, it is about how we future-proof against a future change in administration, a future change in the way that things work, to make sure that the visions and the aspiration, the things that we don't want to see happening again, are absolutely protected and locked in at this stage.
Thank you. Adam.
Thanks. I think in terms of the hopes for this, actually, and not just about the bill itself, but for our national care service, is about how we can deliver the necessary reform for social care that we require this in 2022 and beyond. You know, I think it's been quite clear before the COVID pandemic that social care was in a very difficult place in terms of its investment, but mostly money buys things, buys the people there to deliver social care, that we were experiencing extraordinary waits for assessment or indeed delivery of packages in social care before the pandemic. And it's an organisation in Scotland been calling for, you know, much more investment and much more reform as part of this system. So the hope here is a National Care Service can deliver that, that it brings together a lot of the excellent care that happens across the country, but also makes it far more consistent. You know, we've talked a lot in different committees that I've been in, and also committee appearances that I've watched, that you've had, sorry, sessions you've had here about you know, the kind of the idea of a postcode lottery for care. Mm. And while I slightly dislike the actual phrase, the point remains is that you can, depending on where you live in the country, your needs can be very similar to someone in another part of it, but you're not able to access what you need in the time that you need it. Or indeed, as we're seeing just now, and reports of care packages being downgraded and more asks on family members to take over more and more care. And I think this boils back to the point about when you are assessed for needing certain levels of care, then the package should reflect that, and not because there's a system that is teetering on the brink, and often is. And it's not just about care homes, but I think this is very much about care in the community and how we can make that stronger. So in terms of hopes for this, is that they'll have the necessary reform, there's far more investment, and it delivers what we all need today, but also for the future. It's not just about tinkering the edges, but indeed something which we want to see happening and being consistent in decades to come. That we can build on some of the, you know, free personal nursing care for the elderly, in a sense, in terms of something that's 20 plus years old in Scotland was revolutionary at the time. There's a big opportunity to kind of go much further, particularly much further than anything else that's available in the UK in terms of social care, putting on a much better footing with parity with the health service, as we saw in the pandemic, where it was often second fiddle. And fundamentally, and last bit of this, there's far more accountability, political accountability for its delivery. And something which we saw during the pandemic was almost the case of social care was crumbling at times, packages being stopped overnight, but not a single soul in the government was able to do anything about that.
And we needed emergency powers to be able to do that.
And even then, when it came to having the powers, the ability to actually change anything was almost impossible.
Yeah.
And I think this is part of it. If we have long waiting times in the NHS, then there's a health secretary that's accountable fundamentally, as we're seeing just now. Obviously, they can only do so much. A lot of this is operational. But at the same point, our health secretary is also the secretary for social care. And I think having that accountability means that members of the public, and if you're using social care now, or family members who are, or whatever, have someone who they can hold accountable for a service which may be lacking.
Yeah. Thank you. That's a very helpful start to our conversations this morning. Can I go to Gillian Mackay? Gillian. We'll just get Gillian's microphone unmuted.
Thanks, convener. I just wanted to come to particularly Adam and ask, so Age Scotland's About Dementia submission highlighted a lack of trust between service users and carers and professionals working within social care, as they've been consulted on change for many years with little result. How can this trust be rebuilt, and will the proposed reforms in the bill contribute positively to that building of trust?
I think actually Dr. Manji may be able to come in on some of this as well afterwards, but I think, look, to your last part first, if you will. I think there's a lot in the bill, although it is pretty vague. You know, I think that's been the general reflection of everybody that's seen it. It's obviously a framework bill. This is part of the nature of what it is, which could do a lot to help here. And this is going back to my point about accountability, and indeed having structures which are not hidden away. And I think if you look at, you know, whether it's IJBs, you know, how many members of the public know what they are, who comprises them, the decisions that they make and how they're formed, indeed how there's any kind of other input from those who use social care or understand it, or even healthcare. I think that's where there's a disconnect. And indeed that kind of, you know, political government, and also in this parliament, accountability for that as well, that they know when they go to the MSP that there's some other levers that they can use. And to your first point about kind of somewhere where the trust hasn't necessarily been as good as it could be, look, we're looking at, you know, how care home residents were unable to have visiting for years. It's not even months, it's years. And we're almost at 3 years now, and we're still in a position where care homes are, doors are closed. Or indeed, the length of time it takes to get a package in the first place. You know, I think it was 2018 or 2019, we looked at waiting times, and I think it was 40% of people needing a social care package are waiting longer than national guidelines to receive it. But for every week or day or however long they go without it, their needs will progress and will become more needy in terms of what they require. And the longer they go without, the harder it will be to recover or to sustain a good quality of life, which is kind of the aspiration of all of this. So I think these are things which we hope the bill can fix. But again, framework bill, it says a lot of very top-level good things in our view, and the kind of secondary legislation will hopefully fix all of this. But... you know, I think the proof will be in the pudding, in a sense. It could do a lot, but it's quite hard to tell just now.
Did Dr. Manji want to come in?
Yes, please. Thank you, convener. I think in terms of the lack of trust, I think the co-design is going to be absolutely critical to that process. And I think within that, it's necessary to allow people to express their dissatisfaction and to be open to that and to allow that to be a strong part of the process. People are very unhappy. They have been let down consistently. And as Adam says, this goes significantly longer than the pandemic. This has been a systemic issue within the social care sector that it hasn't delivered for people's hopes and aspirations. And it hasn't even been able to deliver very, very basic needs. So I think having the space to absorb and allow people to process that anger, that resentment openly, I think is a very healthy approach. I think then very much the proof is going to be in the eating. And I think it is about that culture change. I think it is going to be about enabling a genuinely preventative approach to social care that takes people at the earliest possible point, an upstream approach that ensures that the support that they receive is there right from the beginning. For people living with dementia, we find consistently it is incredibly difficult to get access to social care support. And by the time they do, they're very often looking at long-term care within a residential setting. If they were to receive that support earlier on, we very strongly believe, and the evidence leads us to support that period in long-term care can be held off, that people are able to live well with dementia for longer, to be able to contribute to their communities. I think investment and support in community-based support and activities is a really, really critical part of that. People need to receive the care where they are from people who they already know. And I think the model of meeting centres that we see developing across Scotland, where you have very small, hyper-localised forms of local support that are informal support, providing support to carers and people living with dementia exactly where they are, based on their wants and their own aspirations, with a co-design approach to the way that they're run and organised, can be a very, very positive way of achieving that. And I think, again, it's that type of approach and model where you see co-design at every level and even in the commissioning and design of services that will help to rebuild that trust. But it is going to take a long time.
Gillian, do you want to come back in or will I move on?
That's fine. Thanks, convener.
Thank you. Sandesh.
Thank you. Adam, if I could turn to you. Having spoken to Age Scotland's own Scottish Ethnic Minority Older People Forum, it's clear to me that we haven't heard enough from people from a BAME community. And I'd like to know what their hopes and fears are. And an example would be, we spoke about tea and how important tea is to someone who's Indian, for example, because we drink chai, not tea. And that matters. And it might seem like a little thing, but it really does matter. So maybe give me a little bit of the flavour of what you were hearing.
Thank you. And it was good to speak to you, actually, at our offices not that long ago about this when you came in. I spoke with colleagues to members of the Scottish Ethnic Minority Old People's Forum. I think it was ahead of Feely, Maybe a year or so ago to begin with, asking about social care in the most broadest sense, about people's understanding of it. And actually, there was a wide sort of disparity in terms of people knowing what this was. Even the phrase in itself, social care, what does that mean? You know, it's actually one of the sort of more eye-opening moments in the last few months than I imagined, was actually speaking to people with regard to the, separate to this, to the Scottish Government's plan for a new health and social care strategy for older people. When you talk about social care, that actually is a bit of a blank look to begin with. What do you mean by that? Is that a care home? Well, yes, it is a care home. It could be other things like kind of home help and care in the community. Yep. So the fact it encompasses so many more things. One of the things that was interesting that came out from members of the forum, however, was that the idea of their view was that, well, social care is free, isn't it? In every sense of it. We don't have to pay anything for that. That's a bit like the health service. It's free. We don't have to sell our homes, do we? Well, actually, you might have to, depending on that. And people were quite taken aback by that. And that their homes meant far more to them and to their families than just kind of bricks and mortar or money or capital that could be used for social care. These were safe havens, safe harbours for family members when they settled in communities that were able to, you know, be safe from racism, to have like kind of integrated communities and that have children and grandchildren who relied on that home. So for them, as much as anything, that was in terms of the paying for it part was really interesting to hear and put across in a way that I hadn't actually heard before. But with regard to kind of the more cultural elements of it, that this partly goes back to the availability of social care, or sometimes the lack of it, and partly to Dr. Manji's point about kind of trust in it, that you don't have options often. You have a social care package, or you have a carer at times, and they are often very rushed. They're often barely able to meet, you know, even 15 minutes at times if you're in your own home. You know, the idea of just 15 minutes, I think, is fairly inhumane if you're requiring care. But to be able to do the things that you want to do, or be able to express that, if you've got a change of carer on a regular basis, then will they be able to remember these are the things that you need, the things that you want? Because care isn't just about having things done to you, is it? It's about having, you know, be able to support you to live your life. And it's a very good point about drinking chai, actually being able to know about this and be able to support that, and having that kind of cultural training within the sector and within the service to know that you know that what that person wants might look a lot different to somebody else. And if we went back a couple of couple of years ago to the pandemic and looking at in terms of support for people who are shielding, actually you look at the kind of food parcels as such as they were, that often these were far from culturally appropriate. They're far from being dietary appropriate either. But people didn't really have any choice in this either. If they were vegetarian, actually some of the things that are being delivered were not vegetarian, not suitable. And they had no other choice. I think this goes back to this line about, you know, in terms of social care, understanding what's right for you and what you need to be able to have to express how you want to, how you need to live your life. And that should be a big aspiration for a national care service, at the very least, if not right now. They shouldn't have to wait for that. But it is a very good point. There are lots of things we haven't heard enough about from ethnic minority older people, or ethnic minorities. It's not just about older people today, but those who may be in the future. But how they would like the care for their parents, for instance, to look like if they can't undertake this. It's a very good point. We haven't heard anywhere near enough. And I don't think, actually, when it comes to social care, we hear enough from many people, because for lots, social care is quite abstract. You know, if you look at the numbers of people who might receive it, it's a lot, but it's also a percentage of our whole population. Not huge amounts, but when you first into your first kind of moment of experience of social care can be in a crisis, and at that point you've had no kind of like training up until that point to understand what it's about, and you're just sort of grateful to at times to get what you get, and at that point it's you can't really shape it.
Thank you.
We bring in Paul O'Kane.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I wonder if I can just pick up on something you said, Adam, around accountability and the Cabinet Secretary being accountable for social care. I mean, would your contention be that social care is not accountable just now to in terms of local councillors, and that people would have a better chance of holding the whole system to account via 129 of me and my colleagues rather than hundreds of councillors? Because I have to be honest and say it can be very challenging as an MSP to hold a health board to account, and I often found in my 10 years as a councillor I found it easier to hold social care to account. So I just wonder if you would expand on that.
I suppose this goes back to looking at COVID as an example, that actually there wasn't very much accountability to social care And some examples, and what an example, a good example I gave of this was when people were being discharged from hospital to care homes, and when they didn't have their own capacity. And there are some health boards or some health security partnerships, I can't remember the exact ones, which basically skirted the courts and they found their decisions to be unlawful, you know, when there's discharge into care homes. But there was no one held accountable for that. That's an example of this. It is a very good point about accountability in terms of finding it easier as a counsellor to go through health boards, but I'm talking about accountability to the public as well. And actually their understanding that what role counsellors have in this, whether it's through IJBs or through health and social care partnerships or through where all the funding comes from, how things are commissioned. But actually when something critical goes wrong, we do have a secretary, cabinet secretary for health and social care. We have a government that has a social care division or department, but actually the kind of reality of what they can do in terms of what the public will understand, I think, is limited. But it's a good point about there can be a lot better accountability as a councillor, but in terms of that public accountability or indeed national accountability, as opposed to just individual cases or individual local authority areas, I think it could look very different. So I think this is where we'd like to see, but if we went back to the point about parity, to some degree with healthcare, you know, I think this is important. They are very much linked. They are different, but they're very much linked. And obviously, there's a lot of the focus is to be in health and in social care, to be in the community, and not in primary care settings, or indeed needing to have people to go to care homes if they don't have to. And I think that's really what we're getting at here, is actually when we've seen a crisis, there hasn't been ability to act, but also in terms of understanding social care, caring enough about it, really. There'll be members like yourself who've been councillors that will understand this like very well, but lots of people just don't. So being able to hold government to account on that is difficult if that's not part of the kind of your normal responsibilities.
Yeah, I mean, I think my point also was, you know, if Mr. and Mrs. Smith decide to make a representation to an elected member, you know, where does that most effectively and appropriately sit? So I take your point, but I do wonder about that more local focus. I wonder if I can, convener, just move on slightly to Age Scotland's submission in terms of what isn't on the bill, mm-hmm. In terms of Feely. So you alluded to what's laid out in the financial memorandum not correlating with what's in the primary legislation. Are you concerned that things are being missed because they're not on the primary legislation? So, you know, things like free personal nursing care rates, removing non-residential care charging, in terms of conditions of social care staff, should that have been on the bill in the first place?
Yeah, I mean, that's a very good question. I think part of this is about how we understand how this bill is going to work and get through the Parliament, you know, and whether there will be commitments to use secondary legislation to do this. Our concern at the time was actually there are headline and flagship things within social care that aren't really mentioned and are really, really important. And actually all their political commitments, you know, with regard to, you know, removing, you know, non-residential care charges, you know, where does that sit in this? You're absolutely right. I think in terms of submission stands, it stands. And having those kind of commitments built into that. One of the things, however, I think where we can all maybe get tripped up on is, you know, the aspiration behind what this, the primary part, is going to do against the secondary part and what's going to be co-designed and what's going to happen there, which we don't really have a lot of sight of. And maybe it goes back to Dr. Manji's point there about more framework with regard to what's being co-designed. So there's something more to kind of work around. But yeah, I think there are some things with regard to money which could be better indicated in primary, sorry, in the sort of the framework part of the bill.
Would you want to move on to your next topic?
Yeah, I wonder if just on that, if I can just briefly pivot to Cathy Russell on that question, just because you mentioned Feely, Cathy. Just do you feel there are things that could be done now that actually would make a difference out with this legislation?
Well, I think obviously on care home charging, I think there's a lot could be done. It would be good if, for a kick-off, people who are self-funding didn't have to subsidise underfunding through the care home contract, because that is definitely happening. And care homes are telling people that your bills are going up because we're not getting enough on the care home contract to cover it. And I think that is really financial exploitation by the state on some of the most vulnerable people in this country. And it's appalling. But what, in terms of Sorry, the other bit of your question there was on...
Sorry, it was just whether you felt that things could be done right now in terms of the Feely agenda?
Yeah.
That actually wouldn't, without them...
I mean, what worries me to some extent is that you're hearing figures mentioned like £500 million for the new structure or, you know, other the audit committees and so on, thinking this could go to over £1 billion, and not one extra hour of care for that. I mean, none of that is getting spent in the front line. So I think we would really like to see an awful lot more done to fund better self-directed support, because that's never really been delivered on. I mean, when my mum was assessed and told we needed a care home for her, I mean, I wasn't told that there was such a thing as self-directed support. I didn't know anything about it until I got involved in this. So that's not really been rolled out to any great extent. And also just the whole, the workforce itself. I mean, you heard a guy onto this committee a few weeks ago, a doctor from down south, saying that, you know, a dog walker gets £15 an hour and a care worker gets a tenner. You know, so, I mean, we're never going to improve care with conditions. We've got to see it as a profession, because I have seen, you know, when my mum was in a care home, some of the most wonderful workers, you know, people who really have great insight, who make people feel really good about themselves. And so there's so much can be done on workforce. I know things are happening with that. I know it's not been totally neglected. There are things happening on workforce planning and... But I think it's seeing the money. It all comes back to resources. I mean, we need to know that there is a way to improve the funding for social care, or nothing will improve. And I also, having been through major local government reorganisations myself, do fear that, I mean, sometimes, you know, to make, you know, you won't make an omelette without breaking eggs. But I do know that that degree of reorganisation, you will lose an awful lot of experience. An awful lot of people will be sitting there hoping that this is their chance to bail out. You know, you will lose a lot of experience out of the management side. And so I think it can be very, very disruptive. I know from the people who were involved in Feely that there is huge support for an NCS, particularly among disability rights movement. Are very, very much in favour of it, because I think there is a feeling that, you know, in a government you're making money available and it doesn't seem to deliver on the front line, and you can't really always tell why, because the whole thing is so confused. So I can understand, I totally get what's driving this, but I do have huge fears about how it will work in practice.
Can I bring in Emma quickly before I come back to you? Emma, you had a quick question based on, I think,
just to pick up, Cathy, what you said about self-directed support, that it's not really working. I'm aware of some local authorities where it's working really, really well, and even within a particular local authority where the perception of my office staff that it isn't working well, there's some folk really getting good self-directed support. And the Minister, Kevin Stewart, visited Dumfries in the summer recess to hear directly from folk the good and bad about self-directed support. So I'm interested to know whether you think that the National Care Service will help raise awareness of self-directed support and what it can do and what it can achieve, because there are folk that are really getting good packages, and I think you're right about how some folk never heard of it, but other folk really know how to access self-directed support.
I know exactly what you mean, Emma. In fact, I was at the gym this week and I happened to chat to someone on the way out, and she was talking about her sister's package from Capability Scotland, which I think was in Renfrew. Her face lit up at how wonderful it was, you know, the care that she was getting, and that was, she has learning disabilities, her sister, she wouldn't be able to manage all that herself, but it is managed for them, but very much in very deep conversations about how her week would be shaped, and, you know, which bits family were doing and which bits carers were doing. And, you know, it was really... and I think the other good thing, I mean, we've all seen Marion and Laura's example from the Feely report, where someone went from having about 40 different carers a week to having a very small care team who really understood her needs and you know, kept her much, much healthier. So I think self-directed support can be great, but it's very expensive as well. And I also think that for people who are approaching end of life, and I was very interested to hear, was it Mark Hazelwood this morning talking about this? You know, likes of, I think a young person, a younger person, a person with disabilities, self-directed support is a fantastic thing. But I think when people are approaching that very end of life stage, where previously they would have been looked after in geriatric hospitals and so on, I think that very often care homes can provide a really, really excellent service. I don't think it's necessarily... I do have anxieties about the extent to which that area of service is being privatised, because I think that, you know, the over-privatisation of elderly care is has not been great, and I think it's a warning for the rest of social care as well, that mm-hmm. you need a mixed economy. You can't put all your eggs in that basket.
And
very quickly, because we
need
to move on.
One of the care home providers that we spoke to in Dumfries, Jim Gatherham, thought that self-directed support should be available in care homes. Is that something that anybody's had any discussion about?
Well, no, because I think the first question that you're asked at a social care assessment nowadays is, do you own your house? And if you own your house, you're on your own. It's, well, go and get yourself organised. You know, there's no... I think when Scottish Care were here as well, they said that self-directed support should be available in care homes. But right now, I would settle for people in care homes being able to get funding at all, let alone self-directed mm-hmm. support.
Okay, thanks.
Paul, talk about co-design and care boards.
Thank you very much, Convener. I wonder if I can just pick up in terms of co-design. To what extent have people felt involved in co-design thus far? And, you know, should there have been more co-design before we got to this bill being drafted? And then I suppose, what would you like to see co-design look like going forward? So I wonder if Alison might want to comment from the family side, and then I can come to the other side of the table.
Thanks. I think in terms of the whole bill, the six of us sit on I think there's 12 different committees that we sit on, and Cathy does take the lead on the National Care Service Bill. I think we've all been able to feed into Cathy's representation on those bills, that it's quite hard to think ahead of a National Care Service Bill. I welcome it personally, because something needs to be done about social care in general, but it's quite hard to see that when you see how broken it is just now. You know, Cathy touched on the workforce. When the pandemic hit and people lost their jobs in pubs and restaurants, it was like, well, why don't you become a carer? Those people could go in and look after my mum the day after with very, very little training. And these are the most vulnerable people in society. Also, the postcode lottery, that is something that has come up time and time again through our memberships. The no accountability. We had public health making decisions, we had providers making decisions, we had managers making decisions, we had care inspectorate, we had social work, we had staff. Everybody could make a decision about our loved ones other than us. And when you have all these laws and legislations in place that were completely ignored, I spoke to Henry earlier. I actually worked for Alzheimer's Scotland when my mum was still at home, and I was really enthused by the dementia strategies Scotland was world leading and what they were aiming to do for people with dementia. And all that was done away with, all that was scrapped, it was overruled by everything to do with COVID. So I suppose we've all got, the six of us all have different experiences, because we've got different conditions, different age groups. And I think we do feel that we've had good representation on the different committees that we sit in, but it does mainly sit with Cathy, so she would be the best to represent.
Sure. I wonder then, Cathy, do you feel that there should have been more co-design before getting to the bill? And what kind of co-design would you like to see in terms of the secondary?
I've actually found it... I think people are really sincere about co-design. In the Social Covenant Steering Group, the staff who are working at government level on that... and there is a real determination to make that work. I think there's a tendency, though, for co-design to be around specific products. You know, like we'll go and we'll have a discussion about the what's in the complaints procedure or what's in the charter. And I notice that the charter actually says in the bill cannot confer any new rights and responsibilities, you know, which I think is a disappointment because a lot of people would have wanted some rights to be quite specific in there. So I think, you know, particularly on the right to see your loved ones. I mean, there are people who didn't get to see their own husband and wife for a year, you know, certain rights, you know. So I think it's... I do worry that it will be around these quite narrow things and it won't really be about... I think the really... What I've found is that everything that the last few years has taught me is that social care is about relationships. It's about not having 40 people coming a week to your house. It's about having a handful of people that you can really, really trust. And it's about... It's all about these things that are really important, and in a way, it's quite hard to what makes a real difference in social care. And there are brilliant examples of really good social care out there at the moment. Is that those really meaningful conversations about how can we make your life is you know better? If those really meaningful conversations take place, that's where the co-design. Maybe you need co-design to get to that stage, but I think that's where the real co-design takes place, when people are working out their own package or working out their own what's right for them, you know, whether they're in a care home or in their own home or some community setting.
Thanks. I wonder if I can come to Henry just on the same point.
Yeah, thank you. So I think that in terms of co-design, that we have had... many organisations in civic society that have been expert in engaging people in terms of co-design for many, many years. And I think it's welcome that there's an opportunity now for that to be sort of perhaps perceived much more strongly in the policy arena. But what I would say in terms of your question is that we've been framed into a discussion about structure and bills, about co-design. I would much more prefer to talk about, we'll look at our long-term care estate, for example. Who designed that? That was designed in the early 1990s, primarily through entrepreneurial investment, and it was never commissioned. It certainly wasn't designed by people who might use it, and it certainly wasn't designed going forward. We would very much like a conversation about alternative models. We'd like a conversation about models that are COVID safe. We'd like a conversation about models that are actually going to suit localities and rural areas and communities. That's the type of co-design I would very much like to engage in. And I don't see that. Now, we can do something about that of our own accord. We can engage people, we can engage the public in these discussions. But quite frankly, I think that if we move forward, assuming that the estate that we've got all the way through is what we have to work with, and we don't become more ambitious about revolutionising that and transforming it, then I think we've missed a huge opportunity for co-design.
I just absolutely agree with that. And you know what we're finding is, I was speaking to one commissioner recently who was saying that a new care home was being built in his area. He didn't need another care home, but it was going to be 80 beds. And you know, so if you allow the private sector to drive what style of care home you get and where it is, and they will base that on where are the biggest houses to sell that might give them the biggest bang for their buck. Then you're not going to get a care service that reflects what people need. You know, you're getting a care service that will make the most money for, you know, for the big corporates.
Could I add to that? I mean, I think that our care home staff have done a tremendous job trying to get through the pandemic in these circumstances. However, I don't think that should deter us from having the debate about what the future does look like. And certainly from our perspective, not only should the design process be about the long-term care, we should be looking at how are we educating people in terms of prevention. You know, we're really keen. There's 30-40% of dementia is preventable. There will be new treatments coming down the line in terms of disease-modifying drugs. So we're hopeful for a significant revolution in terms of how we approach from the point of prevention to diagnosis to integrated advanced care. And at present, I think that's all down the line. Everything's down the line. We need to be talking about that now and engaging the public in these discussions at the present time, because I think that the public just simply do not understand, you know, what care looks like, how much it costs and what they're facing going forward.
Thank you for that. That was very helpful. I wonder if I can move on just to talk about care boards and the whole concept of care boards. Do you feel that there's still too little detail around what a care board will do, you know, what its composition will be, including who will have the voting rights within that care board? I wonder if I can come to Dr. Manchin first.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you very much. I think we were disappointed that the membership of care boards didn't appear in detail in the legislation. We really welcomed the emphasis on lived experience that was given within FELE for the membership of care boards, and I think that that is a significant opportunity. We did some work around about a year ago, talking to people living with dementia, talking to carers of people living with dementia, and interviewed somebody who was currently serving as a member of a care board as an unpaid carer rep, to explore what they would need to get out of that experience to make it meaningful and how to make it as easy as possible. Because I think it is a big ask of somebody to serve on a board such as that. And I think if we put that pressure on just one individual, it becomes an even bigger ask. So what I would like to see, and what our members would like to see, is more of an emphasis on maybe pooled approaches, so that you have a number of people who are with lived experience that can attend the board. I think as an absolute baseline, there needs to be voting rights, and there should be full participation, because if you're going to sit on a body, then you need to have the opportunity to make those key decisions. And I think that expertise needs to be recognised. I think that's about parity in terms of recognising that expertise. I think we need to look at what training and support is given to people. And one of the wonderful suggestions that was made by one of our members was that care board members need to be trained in how to support and listen to people with lived experience. At the moment, the training is all in the other direction. The carers and people with lived experience are trained on how to serve on a care board. And often it can be quite a frustrating experience when their expertise is not recognised, is not welcomed, is not acknowledged. I think there is a huge role for the third sector as well. I mean, that has been a consistent recommendation since integrated joint boards were first created, that the third sector needs to have a role there. And I think that needs to look at not just the large third sector organisations, but some of the very small grassroots voluntary organisations who could also play a significant role in supporting people with lived experience to access care boards and to be able to fulfil their duties and represent the views of people with lived experience within that local area.
Thank you. We need to move on to questions. Still on this theme, but from Emma, and then I'll go to Gillian Mackay. Emma.
Thanks. Just a quick question. I suppose... and it could be for Dr. Manji or others as you think about it. As care boards are established, what do you think is going to happen with integration joint boards and health and social care partnerships and I guess the movement of people, the flow, how do you think that will be perceived and how do you think that would be implemented then in practice?
I'm not sure that that's something I feel that I have sufficient expertise to be able to comment on at this point. I'm happy to defer to another member of the panel.
I think we've got substantial historical evidence, and Cathy mentioned some of it earlier, about mass integration projects, and we've also seen, you know, the attempt of the IJBs to sort of come together. What we find, and I think what you'll find in most circumstances there, is that a lot of mergers are very unsuccessful because the cultures don't merge together too well. And I think that what we've got at the present time is a real split about whether or not a national care service is a good or a bad thing. Now, I think that we probably have to take time to win people over to the fact if we're going to go down this route, you know, we should be including the staff and the people who are involved in this in that co-production too. We shouldn't, it won't work if we try and just impose it. We have to make sure that people want to believe in it, feel valued as part of it and engage within it. And that's just those that you're talking about perhaps coming under the one banner of a new service and all the 2P issues and stuff that will have to be dealt with there. There's significant issues and significant challenges there, and many of us will have had experience of dealing with these matters. But I think in terms of the social care workforce, what I would refer you to is that I was a member of the Fair Work Convention and chaired the social care inquiry for 2 years. We produced a very detailed research report that made several recommendations about the social care workforce prior to the pandemic. It was published in 2019. Many of the things that we were arguing for at that point, such as having a voice for this workforce, I mean, this is a workforce of 200,000 people, mainly women, who don't have any collective voice. There's no national negotiating position for them at all. Government have tried to support them through small increases in living wage. But what you need is a stabilised set of terms and conditions and contracts that people who are in that environment will all be offered, and it can't be left to the vagaries of different organisations to try and get a competitive edge over that. So I think you've got the social care workforce that need that depth of real support, engagement and absolute security. I mean, it really is quite... You can't imagine how insecure it is for someone coming in a job, working in smaller 4-hour contracts or 0-hour contracts, but ending up working 60 hours per week. I mean, all of these things were highlighted in that research, and Derek Feely spent a lot of time with us at the convention looking at that and made some recommendations on that, but that needs to be driven forward sooner rather than later, I think, alongside that big merger issue that requires a lot of work.
OK, just another wee about establishment of the care boards and the... As is part of this bill, looks at training and the recognition of the exemplary skills that are required in order to provide care at home or care in a care home, and you know, and I think there's career pathways that need to be thought about, established, progressed, because obviously we do need to value the people that feel less valued at the moment who are providing care. So do you think the bill actually is able to, create this formalised recognition of the skills that are required to be a carer?
Yeah, I mean, I think we've already got some good sort of criteria in terms of Social Services Council registration. So what I think needs to happen is that we need a national set of sort of terms and conditions, a national set of agreements that become part of the ethical commissioning processes that we talk about. Now, one of the biggest challenges that organisations face just now in the caring sector is they're signed up to non-committal framework agreements. And what that means is that they don't know how many hours' worth of care they're going to be asked to provide. And if you trace that back, that's where lots of the potential difficulties with staff recruitment, retention, your management infrastructure, how many staff are you going to know? You just don't know that. So people then hold that back until they're asked for that provision. Now, I would say that we should have set terms and conditions, part of any tender agreement, part of any contract, part of any part of this new service, that everyone knows how much the supervisors will be getting paid, how many supervisors you require, what your training days will be, what your sort of like support structures will be, and what your expectations would be. I think it's a great opportunity to fix all this, because that's very broken just now.
OK, thanks.
Go to Gillian Mackay and then Carol Mochan. Gillian.
Thanks, Convener. Just off the back of the theme on co-design, I was wondering if I could ask Cathy about what her views are on how we ensure that the process of co-design going forward is ethical and sustainable for people to be able to participate in. We're very aware that there's multitude of work streams on the go at the moment, and I have a bit of a concern about how individuals or small organisations can continue to participate in co-design throughout the implementation of the National Care Service.
I think it is very difficult. I mean, I have found, I have tried to encourage people to join the lived experience panel, and some of them actually went to initial meetings and pulled out, because they just feel, we've done the dementia strategy, we've done this, we've done that, we've been, you know, consulted to death. We just want better services. So I think it can be quite difficult to get people to be involved. And I also feel that certainly within the care home community, you won't get people who work in care homes getting involved in any co-design, because they are just trying to get their shift in, or their management are busy pulling shifts. I think it was the woman from the from Scottish Care, Karen Hedge from Scottish Care, said that it's hard for them to make people available to participate in a lot of these things. But I think people need to they need to know very much exactly what it is they are co-designing at that stage. And when it comes to likes of the structure of care boards, we don't know what a care board is. Is a care board a provider of services? Are they going to employ people who do caring? Are they going to be the kind of, you know, so that they do have that ability to send in the troops if needed in an emergency situation? Or are they always just going to be commissioning? Who are they going to be commissioning from? So I think, you know, there's an awful lot we don't know about what a care board would look like.
Can I bring in Alison wants to come in, and Henry wants to come in as well.
It was just very quickly to add, I have never been involved in any kind of consultation before. I got involved in Care Home Relatives Scotland, and when there was consultations out on Anne's Law, care standards and things, and we would encourage our members to get involved as much as possible. And I think on Anne's Law there was 268 responses. And the policy team told us that was quite a good response. And you think, this is a country of over 5 million people. We should be getting better than 200-odd responses. But I think it comes down to, if people have never had any experience of social care, they have no idea about what goes on. So given the scale of this proposal of a National Care Service Bill, it really needs the whole nation to get involved to have their say. Now, I don't have a magic answer for how you do that, but I think it is a much bigger discussion. And I know even some of my friends and relatives, when I was talking about Anne's Law, I had to put it in black and white about, well, what if you had been cut off from your daughter, or you never hugged your grandson for a year and a half? And it's only then you suddenly see that realism. So what would you like your care to look like if this happened to you? Because nobody wants to think about getting old or having a disability or an illness that really impacts their life. But I would definitely like to see more engagement, much wider engagement, and encouraging people to have their say, because if this is the next biggest thing to the National Health Service, then it needs a national conversation. But I wish I had an answer for you.
Okay, Henry.
I just think what's very important is that the co-design has to come in stages and steps, and I think there's, you know, I think have to be a wee bit careful. There's a bit of the king there's no clothes on, because if you say to everyone, like, we'll co-design it, but then we say, well, no, we're not going to do that, you know, there's a real challenge there. And I think that we've had Scottish Dementia Working Group, which is a group of activists diagnosed with dementia for 21 years, involved in detailed co-design. Cathy mentioned it across national dementia strategies. Okay, but you have to take something to the table, and you have to make sure that people have some sense of, like, you know, what options are there, what things might look like. You have to then, you know, think about the individuals, for us, for example, who have got progressive advanced dementias, who can't engage in consultations, who are not part of that voice, who probably are getting treated the most unfairly in our system. So then I think that's where you have to rely a bit on civic society and organisations such as the charitable and third sector to be able to have a voice for individuals, not speak for those that are able to speak for themselves, but some groups cannot engage in this process, and their needs are probably the highest ones that we've got to try and tackle. So I think that this type of engagement and the consultations that are taking place allow some opportunity for that, but co-design will not be a panacea and will not resolve every single issue that we've got. And at some point, somebody will have to say, no, we're not going to do it that way, we want to do it this way, and then see how the co-design sort of principles can be held throughout that process.
Okay, thank you. Carol, you had a question.
Yeah, I just wanted to very quickly, I know, to ask Henry, if you don't mind, you know, it is disappointing that the 2019 Fair Work stuff hasn't moved forward. Yeah. Can I just be clear, are you saying that we could do that stuff now, we could do a lot of that stuff now, and particularly around paying the social care workforce would make a big difference, and then possibly move on to the framework bill, etc.
Yeah, 100%. That report, I mean, the Fair Work Convention prioritised social care back in 2015-16. I was able to take a 2-year commission on that. We had a national group that we consulted on. We commissioned 2 pieces of research from Strathclyde University, first class piece of work, also incorporates so self-directed support within that, and every recommendation there could be implemented right now. Now, there's been some work done, and it was delayed, obviously, with the pandemic, but the most important thing that I would want to say is this workforce have no collective voice. Now, if you think about every workforce just now that's connected to public service and public sector, they've got a voice and they've got someone arguing for them. No one's arguing that this workforce receive 5% or 6%. Yep. That needs to be put in place, and it needs to be structured in such a way to fill the void that's there at the present time if we're going to give our social care workforce the rights and the opportunities and the securities that they deserve. And I would also add that every single problem that sits within the NHS just now, 1,800 people waiting to get discharged, lies in that social care issue, which could be fixed by some of the recommendations that were put in place.
Lovely. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Now move on to talk specifically about Anne's Law, led by Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. Cathy, you said that everything that we're talking about, it has to have an effect on people's lives for the better. So within the National Care Bill, how can we make sure that, specifically in relation to Anne's Law, that, and one of the things within Anne's Law was that we were trying to look at making sure that residents in residential care had the same rights as somebody at home. So how can we encompass that within the National Care Bill? How can we do that well? What would that look like?
I think I'll pass over to Alison for much of this, but one thing that I would say is that in the bill itself, it does say, for example, that there should be a right to respite care for carers, and that is clearly expressed as a right. And we would like the bill to have something really quite clearly expressed as a right to have visitors and to go out within the care of your care home. So we would like that there, but we've been doing a lot of work with a team at Scottish Government and Alison. So this part of this is being co-designed. Thanks.
I think maybe just for a bit of context, Natasha Hamilton started the petition for Anne's Law in July 2020 through desperation of not being able to see her mum who was in a care home. Now, reading through some of the research papers that Lady Poole had instructed be carried out before she stepped down for the COVID inquiry, there was three reports on specifically looking at care homes, and I looked at them last night. Now, essential visits were there right from the 13th of March that said they were for end of life, somebody with in distress. It specifically mentions dementia, learning disabilities. And out the six of us, four of us asked for essential visits and none of us got it. I didn't know about essential visits until I had a conversation with Jim Pearson from Alzheimer's Scotland until September 2020. All four of us were all told that essential visits were for only end of life. And we know that some people didn't even get to see their loved ones at the end of life. Now, if all the rules and regulations that were there to support people in care homes, adults with incapacity, power of attorney, if those had been respected, we wouldn't be sitting here talking about Anne's Law. Those reports mention about restrictions on human rights, right to family life and deprivation of liberty. I also found out for the first time last night that the instructions when restrictions were brought in, that people were kept in their rooms. They were not animals. But we have progressed, thankfully, and it is noted in the research as well that the guidance certainly became more humane when we started having conversations with Jean Freeman and the move. The Act, it's actually noticed that human rights are only first mentioned in the guidance in February 2021. So the National Care Service, I suppose, what do we want it to do? We want to ensure that this is never allowed to happen again and that there is accountability for decisions. We were really pleased that when the new care standards came in, they certainly reduced any complaints that we heard from people being locked out, and that was earlier this year, and we were still suffering from Omicron as well. So certainly the two new care standards have helped, and then the introduction of Anne's Law, which gives the ministers the power to set directions with the default position that visits should always take place. Now, the First Minister stood up in the Parliament at the start of the new Parliament last September and stated that she would bring in Anne's Law, which would give relatives and friends the same access rights as staff.
And there's been some challenging conversations with the ANSLAW policy team, but we met with them last week and we have seen a revised version of the directions which we are confident will work. And they've certainly been cut down from 7 pages to 1, which for us, it's always been, as the First Minister said, that families and relatives should always have the same access rights, and staff don't get directions to go to their work, so why should we? I think the National Care Service Bill should enshrine all the things that we've spoken about accountability, about a valued workforce, because it has absolutely been a postcode lottery across the country as to what access you get, and also a postcode lottery as to the staffing that you get. I mentioned earlier that we do see a very broken social care service just now, troubled with staff recruitments. They're just not valued, but they're valued by us, as because they're looking after our loved ones. I don't know if that answers your question.
Does anyone else want to come in on this aspect?
Yeah, I just want to support what has been said, but also I think that during the pandemic, public health held all the cards. And I think that we didn't have necessarily counter evidence. We didn't have the opportunity to challenge. There wasn't, you know, when you asked for evidence, when you were looking for, you know, why are you making that decision? It took a long time to get that evidence, so it left people in very difficult positions. I just think that if you make something a right, then you have to work back from that. So you can't give somebody a right and then take it away because public health make a blunt decision about things going forward. Now, we feel we're going to live in a world with pandemic fears and issues will be with us for a long time. Yep. Love that not to be the case, but I think that's what we've got to think about. So in line with redesigning the property and the structure and the estate to make it COVID safe, I think you've got to build these rights in so that they actually are unequivocal. And when you've got an unequivocal position, you'll find a solution. When you've got the opportunity for an opt-out, you'll take the opt-out, particularly if you think there's a risk to you as an organisation or any policymaker. So I think it's got to be really strong, really clear, unequivocal going forward. Now that we've got vaccinations, we've got testing, and we've got evidence that have all came to the fore over the past few years.
Cathy wanted to come in.
Yes, what was really wanting to see was that I feel that the problem we had was we always had rights. I mean, we always had human rights. We always had a right to family life. I was my mother's power of attorney. Those rights were there. They were adults with incapacity, the rights under that legislation. The problem was once the pandemic struck, they were all forgotten. And we could have... We always believed that if we could have got into court, we would have won a case on the human rights issues. I mean, I didn't get in to be with my mother for, apart from one very short and difficult visit, for a year. I was a full year before we really got, you know, I mean, I could see her through a closed window or for a while through an open window, but I didn't actually get to sit beside her or be her companion, which is what I was. But I think that what we needed was a way to challenge it. And I think that's the problem with quite a lot of this bill as well, is that it's not clear, you know, there might be a complaints procedure, but there is no access to justice if you have needs that aren't met, or, you know, or if even ANSLAW isn't met, how do you challenge that? You know, it's not clear to me that there is any mechanism for that at all that would ever be affordable to ordinary people.
Okay, thank you. Evelyn, can I bring in Tess? Yeah, Tess.
Thank you, convener. So I've got a question, if I can ask Dr. Manji first and then Cathy Russell. So the question is, do you feel there's a lack of ambition in the implementation of ANSLAW, and are you satisfied with the pace of change? So,
I think the pace of change is too slow. We know that this is effectively still happening. A member of About Dementia told us just 2 weeks ago that her mother in a care home in East Ayrshire was in lockdown again because there was an outbreak of norovirus within the home. Now,
norovirus has been around for a very long time, and there are very well established mechanisms for treating and infection control. There is absolutely no need in that situation for an entire unit within a care home to be under lockdown. So it's incredibly concerning that this is still happening, and I think that speaks to the urgency of this issue.
Okay, that's alarming.
Very.
Thank you. Kathy.
I think we've found since the new health and care standards have come in that we've not... I mean, Anne's Law is a very limited thing. It's not about... It is about the right to visit during an outbreak. You know, it's not... because without an outbreak, people should be able to come in and out of care home like it was their own home. You know, it's not... there shouldn't be any limitation on visits or, you know... Or that sort of thing should just be quite straightforward. It's when there's an outbreak. The issue of norovirus, we have had a few cases where homes have been shut, and our argument to that is, and this is where we're quite happy with the current directions, have moved in this direction, it's about saying our relatives cannot live without supportive carers, and that at least one or a couple of their relatives need to be counted in with that cohort of people who look after them. And that's really what I think the most recent terminology we're using is essential contact person, who would always be allowed to get in and see their relative, regardless of, obviously, where there is, say there was an outbreak of Legionella or an outbreak of something in a care home, and the home could be saying to people, we do have an outbreak, you want to leave it for a few days or a week till we work out what the situation is and get back to you. But what we want to happen is if that person really feels this visceral need to get in and advocate on behalf of their loved one or see them, then they should be able to do that using all the same infection prevention control measures as staff would use in that situation, because we're not any different from the staff. We are our loved ones' main carers.
Bringing Alison.
Yeah, it was just to add, the only lockdowns I ever knew were when norovirus had happened, and it was just accepted that that was one of the things that they had to get through it because it spread like wildfire. But now I think, having been through the pandemic and had that enforced separation, I think there just needs to be a bit more common sense about it, and that's where certainly if that was to happen to me again just now, I would use the basis of Anne's Law to say, look, you could be shut down for 3 weeks, and instead of just accepting it as we did in the past, because we now know the damage that it does, it's just to say, look, there are these care standards. If my mum wasn't infected or if she had come through it, then, you know, let's just use common sense to say, well, can I see her in the garden? Can I take her out for a walk? Can she come in my car? But I don't think we should ever go back to those enforced lockdowns. But previous to COVID, nobody thought twice of being shut for 3 weeks because of norovirus.
Okay. Henry.
I think what we try to do is to present evidence on the detrimental nature of some of the measures that were taken during lockdown, the hidden impact report we produced. That doesn't receive the same weight as if you look at the world through an infection control prism, as opposed to through a person-centred prism. And I think that the impact and the lasting impact of the decisions that were taken, you know, have yet still to be fully felt and resolved, the trauma that people are experiencing. You know, we've got an action and rights team that are still dealing with many issues and many complaints. We've got a counselling service that's dealing with the aftermath of this. But what was the most important thing is that I feel that we have to place the right level of weighting on the impact of the individual and indeed their carer, alongside the risk management issues associated with infection control. Now, to date, risk management, infection control always wins out, but we're in a different world now, a different place, we've got different measures, so we've got to start to campaign to get the person-centred practice, the humane issues and impact on a level with that. And public health should be made to account when making decisions about the impact of that assessment. When they're doing, I know they will consider that, but nothing like as strong as perhaps it should be.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on to talking about
unpaid carers and breaks. Emma.
Convener, so this part of questions are about unpaid breaks for carers, and in the bill that's proposed, there's three pages of rights to breaks for carers, section 38, and you know, in the framework bill's a pretty short bill, but we've got three pages dedicated to breaks for carers, and we've had some feedback about from different people that says, yeah, you know, what is a break? Is it a break for everybody? Is it a break to get out? Is it a break to, you know, to completely disengage? So I'm interested to hear any views on what you think in the bill as far as breaks for carers, especially unpaid carers, and is that sufficient to achieve the breaks that are required? Dr. Manji.
Thank you, Convener. I think we're also concerned about the lack of definition for what a care break means. I think from the point of view of our members, I think flexibility is key, and I think that person-centeredness, it often doesn't need a long break away from the person that you're caring from. Actually, sometimes leaving the person that you're caring for can be more stressful than it would be to stay. So is that about having time to sleep? Is that about finding other ways to practice self-care and self-management? Is that an opportunity to do something together and be able to enjoy time together? Is that the support to get out of the house, a lift, equipment, what have you? I think there's something really important and special about a term that one of our members came up with, which is enabling the ordinary, and it's about recognising those, the everydayness and the importance of those everyday interactions, eating a meal, getting that rest, being able to do other chores around the house. What we're hearing consistently is that at the moment, carers are not achieving their entitlements under the Carers Act. And I think that is something that absolutely needs to be addressed within this legislation. We had two sessions recently. We've been consulting on the National Dementia Strategy. And we had two sessions recently where there were a group of carers and we asked how many of you have heard of adult carer support plans? And most didn't know anything about them. Of those who knew, none of them were actually getting an adult support plan or had any support in place. Now, these are all carers of people living with dementia within a community setting, albeit, so possibly at an earlier stage, but it was really concerning that this is a story that we've been hearing consistently since before the pandemic. So I think having that emphasis, it's great to have, as you say, three pages within the legislation about that, but I do think we need to have that pinned down to what it means and to have the flexibility to ensure that carers are able to get the best possible impact from those care breaks, that the breaks are shaped to what their needs are rather than to what the needs of the service are.
There's a fantastic depth of experience through short breaks, creative break schemes that demonstrate how well this can work. Just towards the end of the pandemic last year, we were fortunate enough to be asked by government about some funding that was available. We set up a Time for You fund. The Time for You fund offered a £300 grant to individuals, carers living with dementia, and it was overwhelmingly utilised for very, very creative, very simplistic things that gave people a little chance to find their own space, very much Time for You. So we saw things like, you know, people getting maybe like a shed in the garden, getting a fishing permit. We saw people do things that actually got them in a short break. And just the feedback, and there is a report that we can share with you on that, was fantastic. Now, it also demonstrated two things to us. First of all, people don't ask for much. Very few people actually ask for the full £300. They asked for things that they felt they would need. So one example would be like a woman asked if she could use it to get a tumble dryer because the time she spent putting her washing outside and getting it dried just meant that she was doing that so often for someone who's got, you know, issues with continence. So really simplistic but very creative solutions rest in individuals. They're much brighter than we are at finding the best way to use small amounts of money. And if you scale that up, that then takes you into the whole construct about self-directed support, because that was the intention behind personalisation, which led to self-directed support, was that the natural support in a person's life will be accentuated by the state funds being given to that individual to make choices about that. Unfortunately, we've regimented that to a point where it's just about four options and about services, whereas if you track back to 20 years ago when that movement was beginning, it was all about creativity, it was about alternatives and substitutions. So I think what we've got to do is put some money behind that and allow people freedom and choice to do what they feel makes the best break for them.
Sufficient is used in the bill, so like sufficient breaks. So if you're a young person looking after a parent or a grandparent or siblings, how is that interfering with your education, for instance? So the word sufficient is used, and I'm interested to hear your thoughts about, like, what do we need to do to have, like, a relationship-centred approach to determine what sufficient is? I mean, obviously, there has to be an agreement with the person who's providing the care, what works for you. And you're saying, Henry, folk, they don't want a lot. They want what is sufficient for them. So do you think that the term sufficient needs more guidance or definition around it in order to make it work for people that are providing the care, the unpaid carers?
Shall I? Mm-hmm. So I think that what we have to do is return to the basics of social work practice here. And social work practitioners and social work skills are about assessing where individuals are in their world, their life, what their strengths and weaknesses, their hopes and aspirations are. We don't have a lot of frontline practitioners that can help people make that decision. So what's sufficient for me might not be sufficient for someone else. And I think it's got to be person-centred. And we've got to make sure the situation you described there is it's not right that any young person is denied the right to a good quality of education and life because of caring duties. That would be entirely wrong. And that needs to be properly assessed and understood, so that what's sufficient for that young person will be entirely different from what might be sufficient for me. But it's the person-centred assessment processes, the practice, the understanding and the skill set that's required to then place into that person's life the right level of support that will accentuate their ability to live well and as independently as possible.
We really only have time for one more question. Stephanie, you wanted to ask about the evaluation and sequencing. Just over 5 minutes left. I hope you can do it in that time, she hinted.
I was panicking there because I've kind of got two questions in
well,
this section.
Do what you will with your 5 minutes.
So, my first question is to Henry and Dr. Maggi. Are there parts of the bill that you would like to see enacted immediately? And are there other provisions that you think we should be taking more time on to co-design around?
Shall I go first? Yeah. Yeah, so I think the issues about paying for care and the issues, as I mentioned earlier, about having an agreement in principle about what the National Care Service will stand for in terms of where free at the point of delivery ends and where paying for care starts, and then what do we mean by that? And personally, I would like to see all of the inequalities that we're highlighting or ruled out as a matter of urgency. I think that we've got a strong legal argument that suggests that the NHS still has duties just now that have been unfulfilled because of the guidance that we've got within advanced care. So absolutely would very much welcome a very quick decision in that, with an appreciation that things might need to be interim to then progress until they become part of the full system. Yeah. I think that the discussions about models of care is something that we've got to broaden out. I mentioned it earlier that, you know, if people live in a rural and remote area and their only option for long-term care is to travel 150 miles and indeed to pay substantial amounts for that cost, why have we not designed smaller four-person, five-person units like we have done with other areas like living disabilities and indeed sort of mental health groups, that we spent decades closing big institutions and creating really alternative community-based models. It seems to me that we've not really even engaged in that debate when it comes to certainly people with more advanced dementia and older people in general. So I do think that we've got to get that type of public engagement around models of care, alternatives. We can't accept that what we've got was ever designed, because it wasn't designed. We need to commission, redesign models of care, high levels of creativity, high levels of engagement going forward. That won't happen overnight. That will need to be resourced. And my view would be that the government can't go and do all that on its own. This is where, you know, organisations like third sector organisations, small community organisations, many people can engage in new ways of thinking here going forward. Sorry, that was a bit long, but...
That's fantastic. And can I just mention, actually, that Blantyre Care Hub is absolutely fantastic in doing some of the stuff that you're talking about there.
Absolutely.
Dr. Manji?
Yes, thank you. I think there are things that are already in legislation that we could be getting on with in the meantime, particularly around self-directed support and the support for carers. I think alongside that, something that's missing from the bill is really independent advocacy, and I see that as an enabler of self-directed support and that personalised carer support that I've already talked about. So, yes, those would be the things.
So I suppose just, Julie, picking up on that point of independent advocacy, and also, I suppose, family advocacy alongside that. I think Alison said something really earlier on that really, really struck me. You said everyone can make decisions about our loved ones except us. And I think that's a really, really striking thing to hear. And kind of, I suppose, talking about the success, I suppose, is about meeting the outcomes that actually matter to people and their families. And I'm wondering what provisions there need to be in the bill that could be linked to monitoring and evaluation?
What I would like to see is a really strong role for people with lived experience in terms of the evaluation. I think that co-design needs to run all the way through. I think it absolutely needs to be an outcomes-focused evaluation, and I think there needs to be a strong emphasis on qualitative research within that. We've seen the benefits of qualitative research. SINE are currently consulting on a guideline for dementia at the moment, and for the first time have included qualitative data, and that's enormously enriched that process, and I think we can go a lot further with that involvement. And not just designing the outcomes in terms of that co-design, but actually working as co-researchers, and there's a lot of evidence about the benefits of involving people with lived experience as co-researchers in evaluation work.
So it's almost continuing the co-design, if you like, to go through the process and keep impact and delivery and policy.
Absolutely, and I think there's something there about trust as well. You may be more willing to talk to somebody who has a shared experience of yourself about whether your outcomes have been met or not. So I think that will support and enable that legitimacy within the system and ensure that evaluation genuinely captures people's lived experience rather than just ticking boxes.
Fantastic.
Thank all of you for your time this morning. It's been very, very helpful and valuable to us as we move on to thinking about the questions that we want to put to the Minister next week. So thank you very much for your time. We're now moving on to the next agenda item, but our guests are free to leave. It's agenda item 3, which is consideration of a notification from Scottish Ministers for consent to the following instrument. Excuse me. That instrument is the Food Supplements and Food for Specific Groups Miscellaneous Amendments Regulations 2022, and the purpose of this statutory instrument is to make provisions for minor technical amendments to units and forms of nutrients in various pieces of nutrition legislation in order to ensure uniform and coherent interpretation of the regulations, as well as alignment with the EU, of which Northern Ireland remains a part. Under the protocol between the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government, this consent notification has been categorised as Type 1, and that means that the Scottish Parliament's agreement is sought before the Scottish Government gives consent to the UK Government making secondary legislation in devolved competence. Does any member have any comments to make in relation to this instrument? Emma.
I did. Thanks, Convener. I have no problems with minor technical amendments to the units and the forms of nutrients in various pieces of this legislation. I just wanted to highlight the part about pesticide residues, because because any time that it's flagged about this kind of language, it just reminds me of work that I've done previously when I was on Rural Committee to do with food safety and food standards and imports and trade deals and things like that. So without going into detail about the Food and Drug Administration's handbook of approved defects, I just wanted to just basically state that I'm happy with proceeding with this because the pesticide residue component basically refers to a widening of the definition or expanding on the potential sources to include veterinary and biocides. So, so on further reading of it, I'm satisfied that this is okay to proceed with.
Okay, thank you. Does any other member have any comments to make? No. So I'll ask you some questions. Is the committee content that the provisions set out in the notification should be included in the proposed UKSI? We're all content. And is the committee content to delegate authority to me to sign off in a letter to the Scottish Government informing it of our decision today? Thank you. So you consent to that. Next agenda item, again, subordinate legislation. Next item is consideration of two negative instruments. And the first instrument is official controls import of high-risk food and feed of non-animal origin amendment, Scotland Regulations 2022, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument at its meeting on the 6th of December 2022, and it drew the instrument to the attention of the Parliament under the General Reporting Ground for the failure to follow proper drafting practice in that one of the statutory consultation requirements was not referred to in the preamble. The regulations will amend Commission Implementing Regulations EU 2019/1793, imposing temporary increase of official controls and emergency measures governing the entry into the Union of certain goods from certain third countries. And no motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. Do any members have any comments to make? No. No members have any comments, so I propose, therefore, the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? No, we're all in agreement. And the second instrument is the Processed Cereal-Based Foods and Baby Foods for Infants and Young Children Scotland Amendment Regulations 2022. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument at its meeting on the 29th of November 2022 and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. The regulations will amend the processed cereal-based foods and baby foods for infants and young children Scotland Regulations 2004 to add additional forms of vitamins and minerals which can be used in the manufacture of processed cereal-based foods and baby foods. And no motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. Do any members have any comments to make in relation to this? No comments. I propose, therefore, that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Does any member disagree with this? No, we're all in agreement. So, at our next meeting, the committee will take evidence on the National Care Service Scotland Bill from the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care. That will be our last scrutiny session on stage one. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you all.